good afternoon and welcome to my favorite part of the show, the pre-drive drive. Now, today's pre-drive drive is going to be slightly different with Jean-André and myself, Taylor, because we're going to be selling you some things. Now, you're going to actually have to purchase them with real money, though, and the proceeds go to good things, which I think you'll be quite excited about. Now, in order to go and have a look at the items that we have up and on offer for you to buy, you're going to have to go to shop.wildearth.tv. So again, shop.wildearth.tv. And we are selling hoodies, we're selling t-shirts, mugs, tote bags, an array of different items. And you'll be happy to know that all these proceeds, like I said, they're going to be going towards funding, hopefully, some trips back to the Mara to see the gorillas in Rwanda, and hopefully even going to Luangwa in Zambia. No, Jean-André is supposed to be humming Louise. It's background music that we've got here. I think it was quite wonderful. And maybe Jean-André will have a CD out for Christmas. What do you think, Jean-André? It was wonderful. So like I said, if you want to go and have a look, maybe you've got someone you want to spoil for Christmas, or maybe you just want to spoil yourself, you're allowed to do that. You can have some retail therapy. You can go to shop.wildearth.tv and have a look at all the different offers we've got. It's only going to be for 5 days. It closes at 12 p.m. on the 14th of December. Or AM, I think it could be in the morning, one of the two. But anyways, you can go and have a look and hopefully you'll get your orders in before the 14th of December. Now, also remember, if you're worried that you're possibly going to miss the very important pre-drive drive, and we don't want you to miss a second of that because it's hysterical, and you can subscribe, so you can click the little bell thingy on the YouTube, click subscribe. Subscribe, because subscribed is not a word. I always need to remind myself that. And like I always say, you'll never miss another show again. You get a little notification. Now, our plan today is probably to try and find those lions. So at the moment, we're just going round and round and round and round in circles, trying to find where we need to go, which is quite interesting. But we'll get there eventually. And we'll probably have a look at the little lions, but if they are sleeping, we won't stay there for too long. We'll go away and we'll go look for something else. Some elephants. I'd like to find elephants today. And then we'll probably go back to the lions a little bit later, hopefully when they've woken up. But look at the sky. It's getting a bit grey out there, and the temperature's dropped. I've forgotten what the temperature was, but it was like 42 degrees Celsius, so that must be well into the 90s. It's wonderful. I even have a towel, and maybe I should put my towel on because I'm feeling a bit warm. Now I feel like a boxer. And this is how I'm going to be doing some of the drive. I can only do this in the pre-show though. But we will drive around. Wow, 101 degrees Fahrenheit. That's too hot. That's not too hot to stop the show, though. It's never too hot to stop the show. I must say, this is actually quite nice, so I do recommend it if you do ever come out on safari. Get yourself a nice, cool, wet towel. Drape it over your head just a little bit, though, just to keep your head and your neck warm, because your head does generate quite a bit of heat. And, sometimes it's nice to cool that down. I've cooled myself down a little bit. I don't know if you noticed, but I trimmed my mane. So my mane is not as thick and as long as what it was. It's the summer cut. It was just too unbearable with the heat. So we've shortened that up, which is quite nice. And I'm very sadly going to have to say goodbye to you. Louise is saying that I have to stop talking nonsense now. But that's okay. Hopefully when you see me next, Jean-André and I will be with the lions. We'll see you soon.
African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to summer in the African bush, the time of impala, lambs and greenery surrounding us. This is Safari Live. to a very, very warm South Africa today. My name is Brent Smith, and on camera with me is my good friend Brian Joubert and his thumb. Today it is a sandal thumb. It's walking through the hot African sand, but one must remember that together we are known as the Killer Bees. So I had a now, and not so scary if you're being eaten, because generally he only eats things that are dead. It is a white-backed. Welcome back. Unfortunately, we did have a little bit of a technical difficulty. We are live from the middle of the African bush, so sometimes these things do happen. So just in case you missed it, my name is Brent Cleo Smith, and on camera with me today is my very good friend Brian Joubert with the sandal thumb as it tracks across the dastardly hot African sand today. It is 101 degrees Fahrenheit, but we must not forget that Brian and Brent together are known as the Killer Bees. And of course, a very warm welcome to Point O View, Windsor Oaks, and Glenwood Elementary Schools for your very own private live school drive. I expect some really good questions from you guys. I'm excited to show you our wonderful home and of course some of the animals that live here. Now, Brian and I saw an elephant from a very long way away, and it was moving through this thick bush, and we're hoping it's going to pop out shortly somewhere around this area. But of course, while we move, there are other fantastical things to spot, and I think I saw one fly away. Hopefully it landed somewhere close by. It did not. But remember, all sorts of questions. I'd love to hear from you. And even if you want to ask about all the wildlife that we haven't seen, if you want to know anything about lions, elephants, leopards, zebras, giraffes, and all the other incredible creatures. Ah, there we have an incredible creature up high. Now, that is a very scary creature if you're a small bird, or a squirrel, or a mongoose. That is the, oh, it is. Wait for him to turn. Oh, he's quite far away. Now, there we go. That is the biggest eagle we get in this area. Now, from point to point on its wings, it is about 6'8". And just over 2 meters, it is called a Marshall Eagle. And if you're a squirrel, a mongoose, a Franklin or a guinea fowl, it is death from above. Now, incredibly efficient hunters, and they are able even to take baby antelope. So there are lots of baby antelope at the moment, so the moms will be keeping an eye on the sky to watch out for the massive Marshall Eagle. off he soars. Maybe he will be lucky and he'll land somewhere close to us, but I don't think so. So he's out looking for an afternoon snack. Oh, has he spotted something that he's on the hunt for? He's losing altitude quite quickly. Oh, is he going to pounce on something? Oh no, he's just gone up again. He was looking for a thermal. Let's just try and roll a bit forward. Brian, should I try? Oh, you still got him? Oh, he's gonna disappear behind the trees. And he's disappearing out of sight. I was hoping maybe we might even see him drop from the sky. I just mentioned he is death from above for quite a few different creatures. Now, with a lot of your bird species, your females are actually bigger than the boys. So I wonder if any of you guys in the schools there can tell me why is a female bird normally bigger than a male bird? Now, there we go. You ask me questions, I'll ask you questions. Why is a female bird bigger than a male bird? Let me know. Okay, let's see if we can find those elephants we saw from a distance. But of course, I'm not the only person out here showing you the wonders of Africa. So let's go meet the very brave James Henry, who's on a bushwalk.
Hello, everybody. It's so hot out here. 101 degrees Fahrenheit, that's 38 degrees centigrade. And it certainly feels like it's about 700. My name is James Henry. On camera today is Dave. Now we're out here on foot, hoping to find some interesting little things while we're out here. We're going to look for some insects, perhaps some birds, perhaps some footprints. And also, just up ahead, behind where we are standing, we've got Herbert. Now Herbert is a very good tracker, and he is hoping to find a leopard for us. There was a leopard around here somewhere, sometime last night. Hopefully we're going to find it. Now I don't want you to worry, because if we do find the leopard is most likely to move away from us, so there's nothing to be afraid of, but it would be so special to show you a little leopard. Now we are of course on foot, which means we get to get a little bit closer to the bush than you might otherwise. Now this of course is a giant piece of dung, right? And it can only have come from the bottom of an animal with a very large bottom, and that animal is an elephant. Now what I'm going to do is break it open. Oh, it's impossible to break open. Let's drop it on the floor. And now we can do my favorite thing, bush. Are you watching? A delicious, delicious smell. I know you all think I'm mad, don't you? It doesn't smell bad at all. In fact, it smells quite delicious. This is elephant dung, and elephants eat such a wide range of plants that when you smell what they've been eating, it smells like spices. So you know what spices are. I'm sure your mum cooks with spices, or your dad cooks with spices, and you can go to the spice rack and open up the cinnamon and the cardamom and the turmeric and all those things. You mix them together and you've got basically elephant dung. When it comes out, it doesn't smell like that at all. It smells pretty disgusting. But this is probably about 3 or 4 weeks old, and it's wonderful. Right, now, what we're going to do, I'm going to tell you a little bit about being on foot in the wild. You've got to walk quite slowly. You've got to watch where your feet are going so that you don't, of course, do this sort of thing. Because if you stand on a stick, something might see us or hear us coming. And you also have to make sure that you've got enough water, especially on a hot day like this. And William, you're wondering how hot it can get. William, it can get up to about 108 degrees Fahrenheit here, so about 42 degrees Celsius. On really, really, really hot days, it can go even higher, sometimes up to 45 degrees Celsius, which is very hot. Look what we've got over here. You see, it's not just about the big animals. It's often about these things that we miss when we're in a car. Isn't that beautiful? This is a fly, everybody, and it smells delicious. Delicious. Now, you will notice that I like to smell things a lot. It smells a little bit like jasmine. I don't know if you know what jasmine smells like. Jasmine smells like roses. I'm sure you all know what roses smell like. And you mix those up with honey, and that's basically the smell that you get from these flowers here. They're a kind of a wild jasmine. That's what we're looking at here. Now, Alyssa, you say, why do I pick up elephant dung? I'm sure you think that's the strangest thing in the world to be doing. Alyssa, I pick up elephant dung because I like the smell of it, and that's one of the reasons that I did it today, but also to see what the elephants are eating. Elephants don't eat dung, or they don't have a very efficient digestive system. So if we look at another piece of elephant dung here, we can tell exactly what this elephant has been eating, right? So if I break this open, I can tell that he's been eating something called a spike thorn tree. Now, you need a little bit of experience to be able to do that. He's been eating some combretum or bush willow trees. He's been eating the bark or twigs of probably a knob thorn tree. And what else has he been eating? In the middle of summer, we'd see some seeds from fruits like marula fruits. So he's been eating zebra wood. Look at that. That's quite interesting. So he's been eating lots of different plants. And the only way I can tell what he's been eating is to pick up the dung, break it open and have a look. Now just remember, I mean, if you go out into the wilderness, I wouldn't go picking up any dung. I'd go picking up only dung that I knew the animal of. And I would only pick up the dung of a herbivore. Now a herbivore, as all of you I'm sure know, is something that only eats plants. And plant dung really doesn't smell bad at all. Now, while we're scouring the land here for the spotted prince of cats, Taylor, our friend, has discovered the biggest gangsters of Africa.
Hello and welcome to all the lovely children watching from Glenwood, from Point of View, and from Windsor Oaks Elementary. We are so happy to have you here. And well, to also show you the African lions. Aren't they incredible? But before I tell you too much more about them, my name is Taylor, and on camera with me this afternoon, we've got Jandre. Now, it was quite interesting trying to find these lions. We went the scenic way around. We actually discovered that they're not too far from a road, but it was the more adventurous route. But nevertheless, we finally got these wonderful cats. Now, I've been on holiday for the last 2 weeks, so I haven't seen these beautiful cats for quite some time. And I must tell you, I cannot believe how big these cubs have got. It looks as though they've tripled in size. So if you've got any questions about these wonderful creatures, and I hope you've been asking lots and lots of questions, we'd love to hear from you. Remember, you can ask your teacher anything you like. Now we're looking at these lovely lions, and I don't know if you noticed, not the whole pride is here. So we've only got 4 lionesses, and then we've got 6 of the cubs, so we're missing 1 lioness. Now, looking at this pride dynamic, this is typically what you will see in a family of lions. Now, Isabel, you were wondering, is it the females that do the hunting, or is it the males, and what is their favorite food? Now, it's quite interesting. It's both of the males and the females. So the boys aren't here at the moment, but that's okay. They're probably off doing a territorial patrol, so marking their boundaries, just making sure that no other males are trying to come through. And I'll get back to your question now. You can see it's quite hot here. It's 101 Fahrenheit. You can see the lions were panting, and this little one is bothering mom and trying to suckle, but they're a bit too old now to be suckling. So Isabel, why lions are so successful is because they hunt in pride. So they're the only cat that will hunt in a group. The other cats are all solitary, which means that they're on their own, which makes it obviously very difficult for them. So the females are the most important when it comes to hunting because they don't have those big manes that the males have. So it's easier for them to hide in short grass on big open plains. But in an area like we're in at the moment, there's quite a different type of vegetation. You can see there's trees, there's fallen logs, there's some grass, there's a little bit of everything here. So having a big mane doesn't mean that you're going to be spotted as easily, as if they were hunting out in a big open grassland. So they do a lot of hunting here. However, if they do go to an open area where the grass is quite short, they'll maybe hang back. Now, the favorite food of the lions is buffalo. Sorry, the heat has melted my brain. So that's what they like to eat, but they'll really catch anything they can get their paws onto. Now, Camden, you were wondering if they will attack us because we're so close. Luckily not, because we've been interacting with these animals for over 30 years. That's a long time. So they've got quite used to us driving around in these vehicles, making noise, listening to me talk or sneeze or do all sorts of crazy things. So they've basically become habituated, which means that they are now used to us. They are not tame. We don't feed them. They hunt for themselves. They drink their own water. So we just come in here. We drive around. We stop at a comfortable distance. If they show us that they're not very happy with us, we maybe move a little bit further back. If they're still unhappy with us, then we will leave them alone. And this is the process of habituation. So if you see a leopard for the first time that's maybe come from an area, or even a lion that doesn't know vehicles too well, you'll keep your distance. And every time you have an interaction with it, you try and make it a good interaction so that eventually they'll be so relaxed with us that they'll come walking right on by. Can you believe that? And it's important though, if you do, or if you're lucky enough to come on safari, you've got to stay sitting down, because if you stand up, you break the outside shape of the vehicle, and that's what could get the attraction of the lions. We're going to sit here for a little bit longer, but we're going to go across to James, who I believe has got a beautiful antelope to show you.
Unfortunately, it's not James, it's Brent. And we've got a couple of different species of antelope there. We've got a young male impala on the right and some inyala on the left. Now, they're all in this little river basin. Here you can see there's a little water hole. And you can see there's a bit of greenery from where there was some water, and that water's gone down. And now there's some nice fresh shoots coming up. So there's lots of animals taking advantage of the fresh shoots. Well, two species in particular, the inyalas and the impalas. Now, it's quite interesting. So inyalas are almost exclusively browsers. And what a browser is, gave him a fright. he just ran a little bit quickly down the hill. Now, you've got to keep your eyes open, because you never know when there's a lion or a leopard around. So even though it looks like the inyalas are eating grass, they're probably not. They're probably eating little acacia plants or other little trees that are growing. So they eat leaves exclusively. An impala, which is the one in front, is a generalist. And that's one of the things that makes them so successful, is they're able to eat both grass and leaves. Here we go. And there's a young male impala next to a female inyala. Now, the inyala is the one with stripes. Now, I'm going to tell you some big words now. This is that scientific name for an inyala. The scientific name for inyala is Trafalagus angazi. Now, normally I wouldn't tell you such big words, but it's a cool story. Now, if we go to the male inyala, which is a little bit to the right, he's the one who's dark chocolate brown. There we go. There's two of them there. Now, their horns grow in spirals, and that's the family they're from. That's Trafalagus. Now, the really cool part of their name is the second part of their name, Angazi. So when the first European explorers came out to Africa, obviously a lot of the animals were new. So off this guy went from a town that is called Durban, and he got lots of people to help him carry all his things as he went off into the bush on an adventure. And he was an explorer, and he crossed a big river called the Tugela River. And inyala don't live south of the Tugela River, they only live north of the Tugela River. And not many white people had been up there before. So he went there, and all the guys who worked for him had never been north of the Tugela River. And he came across this animal, and he went to his Zulu staff, and he said, "What's that antelope?" And they said, "Angaz." And Angaz is Zulu for "I don't know." So he thought that was actually its name. Its name was actually Nanyala, but therefore when he named it, when he gave it its scientific name, it became a spiral-horned "I don't know." So I don't know if they're Nyala mines. I don't think so. But we're going to keep on moving on, see what else we can find out here in this wonderful African bush. I've seen a very pretty kingfisher. And let me see if we can catch a glimpse of him. He just flew off. He's going to go for a swim. Boom! There we go. Probably having a drink. Lovely camera work, Brian. Wow! How quick was Brian to keep up with that kingfisher while it went for a drink? There we go. It's called a woodlands kingfisher. A very beautiful bird. Look at that electric blue colouring. It's about as electric as Brian's camera work was there following the kingfisher. Now, it's not uncommon to see these kingfishers dunking down into the water just to cool off. So basically, they're like swimming. But being a kingfisher, you don't want to swim too much. You don't want to get your feathers too wet so you can't fly. So they just dunk in and out. Very, very pretty. Now, we're going to keep moving. Madison would like to know. There we go. He's off again. Boom! That one's just a drink. He wasn't swimming that time. Oh, he's going back again. Oh, he's so fast. There we go. Well done to Nyla. Nyla says female birds are bigger because they have babies. Spot on. Very, very clever little girl there. Now, it's because they have to develop eggs. And obviously, eggs, they need a lot more sort of reserved energy or reserve fat, reserve food, so they can produce the egg and produce the babies. That's why female birds are bigger. Okay, well, let's leave the beautiful woodlands kingfisher and carry on moving. And while we move, Madison was wondering, hi Madison, how many different species of animals do we normally see on every game drive? Well, let's work it out. We almost always see impala and nyala. Zebra, wildebeest, duiker, steenbok, sometimes giraffe. Well, I'd say probably every drive, anywhere from about 8 to 15 different mammal species on average. That includes some really cool ones like lions, leopards, and elephants. I think I'm going to go look for a leopard. That's what I'm going to go do. And hopefully, fingers crossed, we'll have some luck. Now, Madison, if I had to count all the other animals we see, like birds and bugs and spiders and scorpions, we probably see more than 20 every game drive. Now, and one family I forgot to mention was the reptiles. And it looks like James has managed to find probably one of the coolest reptiles we get out here.
Hello everyone. I fell asleep here sitting with my new best friend, Thomas the Tortoise. You see him there behind me? You might call him a turtle, but that's not what he is. He's a tortoise. And a tortoise is a land-dwelling chelonid. Try and say that in one breath. Land-dwelling chelonid. So he is very similar to a turtle, but a turtle lives in the sea. A terrapin is another kind of chelonid, which lives in fresh water. And a tortoise lives on the land. And that's what this one is. And he's a special kind of a tortoise called a leopard tortoise. And you know, I think this guy, Thomas, is probably over 60 years old, maybe. that they don't get much bigger than that in this area. They grow until the day they die, and they can live to well over 100 years. Now, I'm talking quietly, of course, because I don't want to give Thomas a fright. If I give him a fright, he'll disappear back into his shell. That's how he protects himself against predators. There are very, very few things that are able to eat something like Thomas, because he's got that very, very hard shell. So what he does is he pulls his neck and his feet into the shell, and that protects him from any predators that might want to eat him. So a hyena might come and try and bite his shell off, and also something like a ground hornbill. A hornbill is a very, very big bird, like a turkey, that crushes the tortoise's shell. Now, Ursula, you're wondering how the animals survive in the hot water, in the hot weather. Ursula, much the same way that we do, you know. What do you do when it's hot? You go and you find shade. That's what I've done here. Thomas and I are sitting in the shade. You might have a drink of water, and what water does is help to keep the body cool. You might also make sure that you changed your activities, so when it was very hot you wouldn't do anything at all, and then when it became nighttime maybe you'd move around then. So it all depends on what kind of an animal you are. Now remember, I don't know if you've done this in your little science classes there in the United States, but a tortoise is something called a cold-blooded or poikilothermic. Just remember, cold-blooded animal. And that means, unlike us, it doesn't have a temperature that it maintains. We have a temperature that we maintain at around 36.5 to 37 degrees Celsius, which I think is about 98 degrees Fahrenheit, roughly the same temperature as it is here today. And the tortoise doesn't do that. And so when it's very hot, the tortoise can go into the shade and it actually loses heat relatively easily. And then when it's very cold, that's when reptiles don't really like it. And that's why you find far more reptiles closer to warm parts of the world than you do in cold parts of the world. Isn't he a special fellow? And he's standing very, very still. He eats largely green stuff. So green sort of grasses and maybe plants like this one here. Sienna, you're wondering why he's called a leopard tortoise. This is actually not a very good example of a leopard tortoise, because a leopard tortoise is yellowish with sort of blackish type spots, which of course is the same color as an actual leopard. This guy, because he's so very old, he's lost quite a lot of that color. But he's called a leopard tortoise because the shell is normally yellow and brown, in much the same way that the fur of a leopard is yellow and brown. Isn't he a wonderful fellow? And he's being so very still because he thinks we can't see him, you see. And Aidan, now you've asked actually a very clever question. It's a good question because it's difficult to imagine. You say, is a tortoise born with its shell? Yes, it is born with its shell, but its shell is quite a lot softer and it's tiny. Just listening to some birds that are shouting. But I don't think it's anything too important. They're tiny, they're about that big, and the shell is quite soft. It's not hard like Thomas's shell is now, and just grows and grows with them and gets bigger and bigger every season. But they are absolutely born with shells. Right, that's Thomas. Let's leave Thomas there. I want to show you one other friend. David, I'm not sure that you're going to be able to get in here, but there's a friend here with by the name of Polly Rinkus. Now, Sean, you've asked a question. You say, do the lions eat the turtles? Sean, what did I just say? I just said, Sean, that we do not get turtles here. Turtles, and I'm going to say this very carefully to you, turtles live in the sea. There is no sea here. That is a tortoise. Lions do try and eat tortoises, but it's very difficult for them to bite them and get through their shells. So remember, Sean, this is a tortoise, not a turtle. Now, there is another very special friend. Here we go, David. That friend's name is Polly, and her surname is Rinkus. Polly Rinkus the ant. And Polly Rinkus is a very common ant around here, They like to live just underneath trees. I suspect that they're running around here because I may be sat on their nest. And if I'm not very careful, I will have polyrhynchus ants in my pants, and that will be very unpleasant indeed. I think we should move on. Right, let's get going. Now, while we move out of this area, Taylor is still with those big, big, hairy, vicious lions. Let's go and find out how their sleeping is going.
You can see they haven't sort of changed too much. They're still fast asleep. This is very typical of lions, especially on a hot summer's day like what we've experienced. And, well, I think that they're probably going to continue sleeping. You can see that little one at the back panting a lot quicker than what mom is. And these poor little cubs are still going to have to get used to the extreme temperatures. Remember, this is their first summer, real summer. And we've only just started to hit the high sort of 40 degrees Celsius, or reaching high 90s, even into the hundreds. But eventually they'll get used to it. Now, speaking about them trying to cool themselves down, Jordan, you were wondering exactly that. And you can see how they have increased their breathing. You see how their tummies are moving up and down, up and down, up and down. That is the main way that a lion will cool itself down, by panting, very much like your dog does. So opening its mouth, breathing in the cool air and exhaling and inhaling quite quickly. Fortunately, they don't sweat very well like we as humans do. And another thing that they will do is, if it's exceptionally hot, is often you'll see them going to lay down near maybe a dam or a watering hole of some sort, and they'll actually lay on top of the mud. Mud that's sort of hard enough that they're not going to sink into, but because it's nice and sort of wet, it'll be nice and cool as well. Otherwise, they just have to find themselves a good spot under a shady tree, and that does the trick too. Look at all the insects crawling on a... Look at all those little ants and things crawling around on that lion's face. Now, Hester, you're wondering how old are the cubs that we're looking at? My goodness. Now, we as guides have a tendency to do this where we forget how old the animals are, and we keep them at the same age for about a year. So I've heard, and I must say I'm a bit guilty of it. I used to do it when I was starting off. I forget that they have aged because we see them every day. And after 3 or 4 months, we were still calling lion cubs 6 months old. Meantime, they were almost at a year old. So now, we've only got one little cub left that's probably at about 5 months now, and she's lying in the middle, tucked away between her siblings. Can you see this little lion cub there? That is my favorite little lion cub. So I reckon she is probably nearing 5 months old now, maybe just shy of that. And the two laying next to her don't look like the two big ones, or maybe the one big one on the left is probably almost 7 months old now. And the one on the right, probably slightly younger, maybe almost at 6 months, or probably around 6 months now. Time flies, but somewhere around there. And the other two look like the two bigger ones. They're lying just off into the distance. I don't know if you can see. You can see one lying just behind the lioness. That's one of the younger ones, also almost at about 6 months. And then one lying sideways. That's one of the older ones, almost 7 months. And well, very cheekily, I don't know if you can see it from there, but behind the trees, one of the older cubs is actually trying to suckle still. Now, Cameron, you're wondering, why do they sleep so long? And this is very important, going back to their hunting strategy. So lions need to rest and try and have as much energy as they can stored up so that they can make a successful hunt. Remember, lions are not very good hunters. So out of, say, every 10 attempts that they make to try and catch something, They may only catch something every three times. And if they spend their days running around and doing all sorts of other things, then they won't have enough energy to take down a big animal like a buffalo. Remember, a buffalo probably weighs three or four times the weight of a lion. So they've got to have lots and lots of energy. Now, I don't know if you can see, there's a couple of little bugs flying around me, and occasionally they're landing on my face and on my hands. They're little stingless bees, and they're obviously just lapping up some of the moisture. We're trying to actually look for one and see if we can get one to land on us. Let's see. But they probably won't now. This is the case most of the time. Let me just have a look here. Oh, we've got a little bit of movement over there. Some of them starting to wake up very slightly now. Now, Aiden, you're wondering, how long can lions live for? Well, it depends on if they're a boy or a girl. But the girls live a little bit longer. They can live up to about 15, 16 years. That's quite old for a lioness. And the boys, they don't really live for too much longer than about, I would say, at an absolute maximum, about 12 years old. And that's for a really old lion. I'd say the average lifespan is around 10 years old. But I don't think that they are going to do very much just yet. Now, looking at all these wonderful little cubs we've been seeing, Sean, you were wondering, how many cubs can a lioness have at once? She can have up to six, but six little cubs is not very common. They can have anywhere between two and four. That sort of seems to be a common number. Normally, when a lioness has cubs for the first time, from my experience, I've seen that they generally only have about two cubs, and then sort of as they go on, they can have up to about four cubs. You can imagine one little cub is a handful. Can you imagine having six of them running around? And well, there are six of them in this pride, but they all belong to different mothers. This is lovely, and this is very much what lions will do all day. Now, Ryla, you're wondering if lions are cold-blooded or warm-blooded. They're very much like us. So my earpiece decided to pop out. Get back in there, naughty. And they're warm-blooded. So they don't need to sit on the rocks like the reptiles and bask in the sun to try and get themselves nice and warm. They're quite happily able to do that on their own. And every now and then in winter, you'll see them cuddling up like you will cuddle up under your duvet or cuddle your teddy to keep yourselves nice and warm. Well, they just cuddle each other. But keeping warm is not really a problem for them. It's trying to stay nice and cool on these hot summer's days that prove a little bit more challenging for them. But I reckon this evening, maybe they'll get up and go and have a little look around for something to eat, maybe even something to drink. But they don't have to drink every single day. And that's because when they are successful and catch something, when they feed on the blood, that does have quite a bit of water in it. Now, Cosmo, you were wondering if a male lion is bigger than a female lion, or was it the other way around? Sorry, I've completely missed that. But it is the males that are bigger than the girls. Ah, sorry, I swapped that around. Is a female lion bigger than a male lion? So, no, they aren't. Unfortunately, the boys are much bigger than the girls. As with most of the mammal species, where the males, the boys, are bigger than the females, there's an exception, though. And that exception is with the hyenas. Can you believe that? That a female hyena, a girl hyena, is much bigger than a boy hyena, which is quite interesting. But hopefully we'll find some of those for you to have a look at. But they're quite secretive. We don't see them too often. We normally just hear them. But it's really impressive if you're lucky enough to spot a big male lion. They are quite impressive. Now, speaking about things that they like to catch, and I said earlier that they like to catch a buffalo. Now, Brianna, you were wondering, why do the lions hunt at night? Now, it's not just at night time that they hunt. They can actually hunt any time of the day, and they're known as opportunistic feeders. So basically, what that means is that even though they're just sitting here sleeping, if a warthog or a buffalo or anything came sort of stumbling past here and they didn't know that the lions were here, they'd get up and they'd try and hunt it. Even if it was in the middle of the day and it was scorching hot, they would still try and catch something. Remember, out of every 10 attempts that they make to try and catch an animal, they might only be successful about 3 times. So they can't let any opportunity go to waste. So I'm sure you've heard the term, a cat nap. That's what they're doing now. They've still got an eye open and they're still listening. You can see, like this female, see how she's just popped her head up just to check around her. Now, Cameron, you are wondering if lions hunt in a pack. They are the only social cat in the world, and that's what makes them so successful. Now, I know Brent is just trying to get to me on the radio. Let me quickly have a chat to him. Standing by, Brent. They were sort of in the middle, I suppose closer to the western side, but they didn't stay on the road for too long. They disappeared, sort of going in a northerly direction off the road again. Okay, just helping Brent. We had some leopard tracks that we found this morning, so I know he's trying to follow up on them. And it seems as though Karula had popped onto the property. And I know that Tangana also came racing through at some point. He just left his tracks behind for us to see. But unfortunately, he's moved on. So hopefully, Brent finds a leopard for us. He's a very good tracker. And I have no doubt that he'll most likely be successful. But you can see these little cubs, though. They get a bit bored of lying around like the adults. So sometimes what they'll do is that they'll wake up a couple of times during the day and play around and jump on each other and then go back to sleep. And they don't have to worry about hunting because they've got mom doing the work for them still. But as they get older, they'll start to enjoy the sleeps. Oh, look how this lioness is stretching out. Now, Matthew, you're wondering if lions have any predators. They do indeed. Even though they are the supposed king of the jungle, the king of the savannah, other lions can be predators towards other lions. Hyenas, even a leopard to some lion cubs would be a predator. Even a big eagle. I've actually watched a tawny eagle almost snatch up a leopard cub before, so you can imagine it would be able to do the same thing to a lion cub. And even the favorite food of the lion, the buffalo. Sometimes the tables turn and the buffalo will actually kill lions. So it can be quite dangerous for these lions out here. But when the animals pick up on them, if they can, they'll give them a wide berth. So they'll give them a lot of space and, well, they'll just keep moving on. You can see that little one now having a little bit of a drink. I don't know if this lioness is still producing any milk though, as these cubs that are trying to suckle are getting too old now and are eating solids. Now, looking at these beautiful little cubs, and I can't believe how big they've got. Tristan, you were asking when will the lion cubs start hunting. I must tell you something interesting. I saw something quite incredible about a month ago. We were sitting with the lions, and they managed to catch a baby buffalo. Now, it's obviously very sad, but the lions need to eat too. That's what you must remember. And especially those little baby lions need to get food. If mom doesn't eat, mom can't produce any milk. But these youngsters are eating solids now, so they're eating the buffalo. And it was the most incredible experience where the little lions had an opportunity to practice all the techniques and how they jump on each other and bite each other. They're practicing, and what they'll do is those things that they practice on each other, they'll eventually use to bring down the prey that they're trying to capture. And they got to practice on a buffalo, a live buffalo, and I've never seen anything like that before at such a young age. Normally cheetahs, the mothers will bring back food that they haven't quite killed properly, and then they can learn like that, but it's not really the case with lions. So when these lions get to about a year and a half or so, they're going to start going out on the hunts with the adults and watching sort of the adults as they do their things and hanging back, but it's very stressful for the adult lions because the little ones get quite excited and sometimes they race out thinking that they're doing good to try and bring down an animal, but in the end they end up ruining a hunt. So they've got, or they have a lot to learn before they become successful hunters like the adults. But unfortunately, it's time for myself and Jean-André to say goodbye. And it's been wonderful. I hope that you've enjoyed these lovely lions. And, well, hope you keep on watching and see what they get up to a little bit later. But from myself and Jean-André, have a wonderful afternoon or morning, whatever the time may be. We're going to go over to James now.
There, everyone. I'm sorry, I have to modify my voice slightly now because we're no longer talking to children. There, everyone, is the baby hardy-dar. And for a moment I thought maybe it was on its own and that the other two with whom it was born, its clutch mates, had unfortunately gone the way of all flesh. But they haven't. Herbert, from a greater distance, has seen one or two other heads popping out of the nest, so I think they're probably all okay. I think it's such fun to come and see these things today. It's a little bit like hyena den substitute for them. I loved going to those hyenas every day, and unfortunately they have absconded, so now I must come here to the hardy-dar nest. It's not quite as entertaining, but it is very interesting to watch. And also in this vicinity, of course, a yellow-billed hornbill's nest and a hoopoe's nest, but I don't think the hornbill will come anywhere near here while we're here. Oh my goodness, you know what else I think we've got here? What we're going to do, Dave, let's go over here. I think that there is either a simitable or a green wood hoopoe's nest in this tree over here. There seem to be a lot of trees here with tree hole cavities in them. And that means that there are a lot of birds that like to nest in tree hole cavities. Look. Can you hear that? Definitely. Definitely something going on here. On the very top of the tree, Dave, that's a simitable. It's got the black beak. And I'm just going to sneak a little bit. Oh, and isn't, can you see the other one? It's just landed on the branch there. I think that's the other part of the couple. This is fantastic. Please do talk to us, everybody, while we're looking here. We're perfectly available to take your questions and comments now. Hashtag safariLIVE, questions at wildearth.tv. Be good to hear from you over the course of the next little while. I'm going to move a little bit closer. Well, I can see another one. There's a baby. There's the baby. I'm halfway up the fork on the right-hand side. Can you see it there, Dave? And I know it's a baby because it's got a very much shorter beak than the adults. How cool is that? That is wonderful. Gee whiz. That is fantastic. So we found a newly fledged simitable. That is brilliant. Now this bird goes. And normally, you know, you see them fly and they just look plain black. You can see that kind of greenish purple iridescent in this kind of light. Let's go a little bit closer. Let's see if it doesn't. And they're also oxpeck calling. Are flown off. There are oxpeckers calling here. Now either there's a buffalo about to flatten us in the bush, but I don't think so. Or there's also an oxpecker nest. Those oxpeckers are alarming at us. They're going ksh, ksh, which is what you listen out for if you're ever walking in the bush and wondering if there's a herbivore around. So there's the oxpecker on the top of the tree. They've also been off now. They're having a bit of a dogfight in the sky. Oh, this time of year is just so exciting, and it's the most wonderful afternoon. If we look around at the sky, you can see there seem to be some burgeoning storms, especially off to the south, and I've just seen a whole lot of sheet lightning there in the background, so maybe we'll have some rain a little bit later. Brent has just driven past us. I'm not sure whether he turned left or right when he got to the end of the road. You can ask him yourselves now.
I'm not telling. No, I'm joking. I went left. So the last tracks of Karula was somewhere down to the southwest of us. So we're just going very slowly, see if she pops out around Drakensberg or Basilea Road. Now, there's been no report of her from the south of us, so, and no sign of her crossing back to the south, so hopefully she's still here. I think the cubs are still down south there. Oh, before it dashes away. There. Hello, little Steenborgie. And standing as still as stone. That's where they get their name from, of course, one of their defensive mechanisms. It's a little male. See his little horns there. Fascinating little creatures. One of the most widespread antelope in southern Africa. And also one of our only non-water dependent antelope we get on Juma. And he's keeping very still. Quite often when we try to see them from a bit closer, they disappear at a rate of knots. They're also monogamous. Now, they are one of the interesting species. There's a couple of species that have two distinct and very separate populations. So this southern Steenbok population encompasses nearly the whole of southern Africa. Not so much down into the Cape, but Namibia, Botswana, Zimbabwe, Mozambique. And then there's a major gap through Zambia, Malawi, and then only again in northern Tanzania, Kenya, do they appear again. Now, there's quite a few different species that have that, and it's obviously to do with how Africa has evolved and changed. So there probably would have been, at some point, a conjoined group of animals. Giraffe is another one, black-back jackal, Steenbok, dik-dik. You've got southern and East African populations, so it's very interesting. And in the middle is the Miombo woodland. Now, Miombo woodland is exquisitely beautiful and unbelievable for birds, but it is a very, very low in nutrients. So away from the rivers, it's very dry, it's a dry woodland. And I find it incredibly beautiful, but also the birding. Also, there's lots of tsetse flies there, so you've got to be quite a hardcore birder to enjoy the Miombo woodland properly. But it is very interesting. I always find it interesting how these two, and when these two different groups of the same species have been separated. Now, generally, quite often, large rivers play a role, and rivers change, and lakes move. I mean, the whole of central Botswana was a super lake 10,000 years ago. Now it's a salt pan, a desert, almost desolate of most life. So it is an incredible thing how, even in what we consider a long time, 10,000 years, which is actually just a mere blink of an island in evolutionary terms, how things can change. And I mean, if we could come back and look at another 100,000 years, will these separate species have evolved into completely different species? They haven't been separate enough, long enough for them to evolve into different species. But in 100,000 years, or 200,000 years, a million years, could it happen? I mean, I find that stuff absolutely fascinating. Now, let's just make sure our dear old Queenie Karula didn't sneak through here somewhere. Ha! Brian, do you think it is time for a quiz?
No, yes.
Do you think it's time for a quiz?
I do.
I think we're going to have a killer bee quiz. Ooh, I think that's a good idea. Killer bee quiz. What are the most different species of cat that the killer bees have had in one sighting? And if you're really good, what are the species, and what is the most species of cat that the killer bees have had in one sighting? Send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag safariLIVE on Twitter. Now, there are a few vultures on the tree. Now, we have to ponder, have they found some meat? Oh, look at the size of that crop. I think they're just full and resting. So that top vulture, you can see that bulging neck. That is a crop full of rotting meat, more than likely. So they have eaten well. There's three of them there. Is it enough to warrant us going to have a closer look? Probably not. I think they're resting now. And wherever they have been, they have managed to get themselves a delightful, or for, if you're a vulture, a delightful meal from a human being, a meal that would probably make you violently ill. Oh, there's another bird next to us. Let me just... is he going to fly when we move? And you see him on that tree wisteria to the left slightly. There we go. I zoom in there. There we go. Sitting on the branch. And the reason... look how it's holding its wings out. So that's one of the ways to keep cool. So it's getting the wind to blow under its wing and cool down the blood that is coming to the surface on those capillaries under the wing. It's still very, very warm and humid, even though the cloud cover is here. And that is, of course, a ring-necked dove or a Cape turtle dove. Everyone's hot today. So Brian and I are going to turn on our air conditioner, which means we're just going to keep moving. I think there's been maybe a little confusion in the question. It was, what was the most number of cat species the killer bees have had in a single sighting? So you had to see more than one species of cat in a single sighting. Justin, you are spot on. I think in terms of cat species that the killer bees have seen together, a lion, a leopard, serval, cheetah, African wildcat. I think that's it. It's five. So different species of cat that the killer bees have seen together. But we're talking about how many of those species have we seen in a single sighting at the same time. Hashtag safariLIVE or questions@wildearth.tv. Kelly thinks it was three. Brian, do you remember seeing three cats in one sighting? I don't think so. Oh, there we go, another birdie. While we ponder. Oh! Dastardly cuckoo. And it looks, and we're just trying to see the chest to see whether it's a Jacobin. Oh, I think it's trying to find a nest. Oh, it's a Jacobin cuckoo. I think it might be looking for the Burchell starling nest. It is one of their favorite brood parasites. So the Jacobin and Levaillance cuckoo or striped cuckoo will look for starlings' nests, and they will lay their eggs in the starling nest. And there's the Burchell starling that often inadvertently end up raising cuckoos to adulthood and not their own young. Of course, their own young are often, well, before they are born, murdered by the cuckoos as they kick their eggs out of the nest. So just to let everyone know, it seems like our Wild Earth email server has crashed. exploded, overheated. So we are not receiving any emails at the moment, and it's not because we don't want to answer your emails, they're just not coming through. So remember, please tweet if you want to get your question through on Twitter with the hashtag safariLIVE. Now also, as it is Christmas season, we must remember that we have now got a few items online that are available for our viewers, and the sale of all the shirts, mugs and other goodies is specifically so we can travel to new places in Africa next year. I mean, we're talking about Chobe Riverfront. Imagine that, seeing 2,000 elephants in an afternoon. Back to the gorillas in Rwanda, Masai Mara, Liwa Plains in Zambia to see the second largest wildebeest migration, and also one of the most incredible concentrations of hyenas and cheetahs and wild dogs in Africa. I've actually been to all of those places, and I would say we definitely want to go there, and I would love to take all of you on adventure to some of the places I've spoken about while on the live drive. So go have a look on our website and on our Facebook page. You'll find a link to some Christmas goodies, and it's only for a few days that those things are going to be available, and if you are in the US, you will be able to receive those items in time for Christmas. Now, we're going to keep looking to see if we can find any sign of our beloved Queen Karula. While we do that, we're going to go back to James, who has got a completely evil insect that has absolutely caused a lot of pain in my life when I was younger, and fortunately I've learned a lot about them, and so I try to avoid them these days. So let's go learn a little bit more about the evil pseudo ant with James.
Now, we have this thing, everybody, on the street. It is evil, as Brent says it is. It's caused me some pain in my life too, but only once. I, of course, have avoided it more successfully than Brent has. And I will tell you, I've been trying to do that now for half an hour. Come on now, you... It's a velvet ant, by the way, which is a kind of a female wasp, which many of you will know them around. Sorry about that, everybody. I'm just trying to wrangle it again. I will tell you that what's happened is that there are tracks of the queen and her cubs all around here that Herbert has just found, and he thinks that she's probably headed south into Little Gowrie. We're right on the southern boundary at the Mulwati, and this beastly little velvet, and I'm so tempted to pick it up with my hands, but I know it will sting me beastlily. Let's try once more to wrangle it onto the stick. I managed twice now. There we go. I am the velvet ant wrangler. Come, velvet ant, come. No. Don't go off. There we go. Isn't that gorgeous? Now, it's a wasp, the female version, because only the females can sting, and only the females can sting because only the female has an ovipositor, which is, of course, the egg-delivering organ. The male's totally stingless. Oh, it's getting close to my hand, David. Sorry. It's very... very difficult. Where's she gone? There she goes. So great. Anyway, we haven't found direct evidence that the queen and her cubs have gone the other side. So what we're going to do is just quickly do a check around this area and see what else we can find. I will, however, try and find you a track in the sand here. Dave can't actually bend over now because, unfortunately, the signal will go. So I'll try and find you a track. I think let's put this poor lady down. Here we go. Here is a track here. Now, it's going to be impossible for you to see, and that actually is important to me, because when we were walking along here, Herbert said, stop here. I see the tracks. Look, there's Karula's track, there's the male cub's track, and there's the female cub's track. I stared at the sand, and with all of my 15 or so years of experience living out here in the bush, I failed to discern anything other than sand. And of course that made me feel distressed and sad about myself, and I had to tell myself that I was still valid as a human being, despite the fact that I was unable to see these tracks. But there is the track of, I think, the mother. I'm getting nods of approval from Herbert. That's only because he told me what it was. And I think what you can see here is the back pad where my finger is, and the four front pads or front toes there. So she was heading off towards sort of the southwest, and the southwest, unfortunately, is where little Gowrie is. And little Gowrie is where you and I, David and Herbert, may not go ever. Taylor is still with the lions. She can go there. We're not going, but you are.
We're still with the wonderful Nkuhumas. Now, we're starting to actually see a little bit more action now, which is wonderful. The little darlings are rolling around. I'm not sure if that's because they're waking up or if the bugs have eventually gotten to them and annoyed them to the point that they have to move around a little bit. But it seems to be a trend this afternoon amongst the Nkuhumas to sort of lay on your back with your legs spread, starting with the little cub. And then with the lioness at the back as well, she's also dangled up against the fallen tree. And I just can't believe that these cubs are still wanting to suckle, especially the older ones. They're being a bit cheeky now. But it's so lovely to see them, and it's incredible to see how their condition has improved incredibly since the last time I saw them. I was very, very saddened by their state as to how thin they were and sort of what they were looking like. So I'm really, really happy to see that they're looking a lot better and are moving around with ease this time around. I'm waiting for my favorite little girl who's sleeping at the back to wake up so I can have a good look at her. But she's not cooperating at the moment. It just seems this little boy is having a good afternoon and trying to wake everybody up, checking all the lionesses to see if they are lactating. Now, no, she's clearly not. Now, I haven't been able to work out who's missing just yet. I'm trying to figure out if it is Amber Eyes or the youngest lioness. I'm not too sure just yet. But I suspect it is Amber Eyes that could be missing, because it looks like it's the youngest lioness that's just lying off to the right of this cub, because she had an awfully pink nose. And of course she's got no suckle marks or anything, so it's one of the two. But we'll have to have a look when they stand up. It'll make it a little bit easier. Hello guys. Oh, he's on an adventure. What are you going to get up to this afternoon, young man? Bless you. Go to the toilet. Check. They're almost quite predictable, aren't they, these lions? They always do the same thing. Go and wake your sibling up. Now, this little bush willow is obviously perfectly in the way, but that's all right. I don't think he'll be there for too long. Come on, little flip-flop girl, wake up. Now, AJ, you were wondering, and it's something that we've actually been chatting about quite a bit over the last few months. Well, definitely a hot topic since I've been working here at Wild Earth. Now, you were wondering, if the lion cubs have mange, will it make its way around the entire pride? It indeed will, and it indeed has, especially amongst the cubs. But they seem to be doing all right. There's a couple, like he looks like he's quite patchy on the elbows, but now I'm uncertain if that is just a combination of maybe mud or buffalo feces. I'm not sure when they ate last, or if it is actually a bit of mange. But I think that they'll be fine. I think they've made it past the worst stages now, and the condition of the animals should start improving, not just with the lines, but of course with the quality of grass, which means that the quality of meat from the buffalo in particular will start to improve too. Now, I was chatting to a couple of the guides down in the south, and a few of them were telling me that the lions down there, the southern pride, started to show some interesting behavior, very much like what we started seeing up here, with the cubs going from being so energetic to lethargic, and you could see their hips protruding, and then they started not being able to walk properly. And isn't that amazing? So it seems as though they also picked up that white muscle disease. I can't remember if any of the cubs passed away or not, but they even started seeing it in the adults, starting to almost look like they had hip dysplasia. I always like to describe it like that, because that's what it reminded me of when I used to have a German shepherd as she got older. And but it seems as though they're okay now as well, since they've had a bit of rain and the grass has come through, so that's lucky. But it does make me feel, I suppose it's the wrong way to say it, but it was nice to know it wasn't just the Nkuhumas that were affected by it, is that it was affecting the different lions in the area as well. Because I think, in general, the Nkuhumas are quite a strong pride. The lionesses look like they've got fantastic genes. They're not small lions, and they don't seem to really have any mange. And I think that those genes are going to shine through with these Nkuhuma cubs, and I think that they've sort of proven it now. They look fantastic. They've tripled in size. They don't look like the same things, the same little lines I saw just 2 weeks ago. But I think what we're going to do is we're probably going to go for a little drive and see what else we can find, but we'll be back here, and hopefully when we do come back, they would have woken up. But let's go back across to Brent and see how his hot afternoon is doing.
Welcome back. We are giving James a hand. James says he can't find any obvious signs of the cubs crossing to the south, but the general direction was south and west. So we're going to head a little bit further west than we've been this afternoon. Check down towards Weaver's Nest and then check on the road towards where James had lost tracks. Maybe we'll find tracks of them crossing, and maybe we'll find them. So we've got a few answers for the killer bee quiz, and the last one was indeed correct, but there are two correct answers. Aha, it was a trick quiz, because the killer bees are so tricky. Oh, the only thing that can distract us slightly from a killer bee quiz is tracks of a leopard, but it is a baboon. Yes, it's a baboon. So we indeed have seen three different cat species, but not all in the same sighting. So leopard is the common denominator, but in both those sightings, the one sighting was a very, very long time ago. Boo Boo, you are spot on. We saw a lion and leopard. And it was at Twin Dams. There was, what's her name? The now expired Kwatile, mating with Imvula, with Karula looking on, and the Styx lionesses arrived. So there was that, and I'd actually forgotten about that one. So thanks, Booby. So, Brian, the one we were thinking of, and obviously, especially since I saw both of those exact animals yesterday, was we had Quarantine the male leopard chase, those two male cheetah. So those are the two multiple cat sightings. Now, believe it or not, many, many moons ago in northern Zululand, I'm trying to remember, I think it was Shimungwe Dam, the Batalier Pan or Batalier Dam, I saw a lion, leopard, elephant. Oh, first baby boar dogs! They're so small! They're so small! They're so cute! I want to eat it! The killer bees! so happy. That's so cute. Look at that. Sorry, Mama, we came around the corner with me making a lot of noise. Off they go. Those are a day old at the most. Well, Brian, you weren't with me for the first baby impala because you were on holiday. Yeah. But killer bees for the first baby warthogs. Is that another first of the season?
I think it is.
Oh, dear. Shh, don't tell the other presenters. What if we had first woodlands? First impala. What else? There's been a few firsts this year. Oh, you know when you get the first, you just start losing track. Let's see, I'm just going to get those warthogs a bit of a chance to move away. They might move into an area where it's a bit more open. Oh, they were so cute. Four of them. Four little sausages. Four little warty sausages. Now, of course, warthogs of that size are proper, proper leopard snacks. And now, I've watched a female leopard many years ago called Vomba actually in an afternoon manage to catch all four of a mother warthog's babies. But Vomba was a special warthog hunter. Now we'll try and get another view of those warthogs, but I was telling a story about many moons ago at Bataleur Pan in at Pinda and saw lion, leopard, elephant, buffalo, and rhino. The big five from one position. That is the first and only time I've ever seen that. I've often actually seen four together, but not five. Okay, she ran through here, so I'm just gonna go slowly. William's wondering, do the baby warthog have little tusks? Indeed they do, William, very, very little. So little they're not protruding out of their mouths yet. Now that's one of the reasons it's thought that warthogs have those big white whiskers. And especially when they're younger, those whiskers are more prominent. And that's because it emulates possible tusks to try and scare off certain predators. Now, baby warthogs of that size are fair game from apart from the cats and obvious mammalian predators, but also to martial eagles. I think even an African hawk eagle would think about taking. I mean, they were literally the size of a sausage. They were tiny, tiny, tiny. But it looks like Mom's headed off into the thick bush with her babies. And we are looking for Queen Karula in this area. So be careful, Mama Warthog. Leopards like warthog babies. Now, of the warthogs we see, the Arethusa airstrip warthogs seem to be very, very good at rearing their young to adulthood. Specifically, since Mr. Anderson and Tingana, both well-known warthog eaters, spend quite a bit of time in that area. Now, we're going to keep looking for any sign of the Queen while we do that. James has found some interesting things to show you that are on a tree.
Some interesting things on a tree indeed, and let's hope we have some success with the Queen. We too, we've kind of come the other way. I'm pretty sure she's gone south, but we're hoping against hope that maybe she came back, and so we're heading up a drainage line here. Now, I'm not pointing at you with a knife because I'm feeling in any way indisposed to your general personalities. What I want to do is cut open a gall here that is sitting on a tamburti tree. Now, I don't know what's formed this thing. Safe to say that in this one, if we look over there, David, can you see there? That looks like a sting. Now, I'm pretty sure an insect has stung this. Why it has stung this, I don't know, but some way to going to find out will be to cut this thing open. So let's take it off the tree. There we are. Now, What we will do is place it upon a board and cut it. My mummy always said to me, if you're going to cut something, put it a board out, please, James, otherwise you'll scratch the countertop. She still says that to me, of course, when she's not shouting at me for not taking pictures of the sun. Or for only taking pictures of the sun. Right, here we go. Now, there is nothing of great interest in there other than the poisonous white milky latex. Now, it is quite possible that whatever stung this has infected it with something and it is going to try and come back and eat here. Alternatively, it's possible that there could be eggs in there, but I don't think there are. I don't see any obvious signs of eggs. We will just chop it once more into quarters. This knife was sharpened by Stefan Winterbur, which means you can probably shave with it. I'm not going to try that. But that's interesting. There is the kind of central red heart of this gall. What did it? I don't know. And why it was done, I'm really not sure. Any ideas? Send them through. #safariLIVE@wildearth.tv. It'd be lovely to know from you. Now, the other thing that we have over here, every time you sit down out here, you find lots of interesting things. I'm just going to fold away my knife, push it away in my pouch. 2 days ago, Brian and I were on walk and we found some drop-tailed ants raiding the nest of a termite. A termite nest. Not one termite lived in the nest. And here is one of those drop-tailed ants now. Now, it is almost certainly going to bite or sting me. I'm going to squeal. But there it is. And the reason it's called a drop-tailed ant, can you see, David?
Yes.
It's got a dropped tail. Its tail, is dropped down towards the ground. Yeah. It's red in colour. And it is different, of course, from the cocked tail ant, which has a tail that goes the other way entirely. So he's very, very doesn't want to be on camera in the slightest. There we go. He's got caught in the hairs of my arm, hasn't he? Poor fellow. Anyway, that is the drop-tailed ant. And I don't think they taste quite as good as polyrhynchus. I think they're filled with formic acid and probably taste very disgusting and will probably bite me on the tongue, so I'm not going to eat those. So, just a quick summary here. Tamburti tree, been stung by something. I don't think it was one of those ants, although there are lots of the ants around here, but this whole tree is infested with those galls and maybe they have a nest not too far from here. In fact, underneath this tree, I think, and maybe it was them that did that. Who knows? Come on then. Let's go down through here. Oops. Herbert has gone up the drainage line. What we're going to do is cross it and walk along the game path on the northern side. And it's just a lovely game path to be walking on, especially on a day like this. In the background, we can hear some baboons going, ha, ha, bow, bow. Which, if you didn't know what it was, would be a terrifying sound. But baboons are terrified of us. One person I'm not very terrified of on account of her sparkly personality is Taylor. She is still with the lions.
I'm so disappointed that I'm not intimidating enough to scare James. I'll have to work on that. I thought I've just heard some impala alarm calling. It obviously doesn't look like the ones that we are looking at, though. It sounded like quite far in the distance. So perhaps we'll go and investigate. I had to put my extra ears on. And well, my extra ears, that is me cupping my hands around my ears. Can you hear that? And I think I can hear a wildebeest, too. You can see those impala looking back behind them, especially these ones over here, but further to the left. Just in the thicket. Not now, she's not, but the other. Let's go up a little bit further. I don't know if you can hear, you probably can't hear that because I'm only just hearing it. Let's go and see what's happening down the road. Go on a little investigation. It's good to know that I have my bush ears back. That's something that I'm always worried about when I come back from the city or the concrete jungle, is that I can't hear anything for the first couple of days. So I'm glad that I could still hear that. Let's go and find out who is shouting. Maybe it was a wildebeest that was alarming. I could still have my city ears on. Right. Those impala look very relaxed. stop and listen again. Now, I know Jamie said she thought she had, well, she said she had some leopardess tracks going through here. So perhaps it is shadow. Maybe she's going to make an appearance. But it's definitely not these girls. You can see they are listening, moving away. So let's go towards the area that they are moving away from. Oh, she's heavily pregnant. Very cautious, and there's a bit of a breeze now, so we know what that means. That with that breeze comes muffling of sound, so they're going to be a little bit more cautious. Can you hear something? What did you hear? Jandre said he's heard something. Jandre thinks it's the lions. Ah, maybe, there we go. Chandra is very intelligent this afternoon. Me, on the other hand, not so much. I think we're going to swap. Chandra is going to carry on presenting because I'm not with it today. So Chandra very, very cleverly said, as this wind has just picked up now, it's probably the scent of the lions that they're smelling. Thank you for reminding me about that. I completely forgot that that can happen. So thanks, Chandra. And, well, we've actually just done a little loop. And we're about to pop up on the power line road again. We know that the lions are around here. So let's have a look again. Now I've got to remember where I put that branch. Was it further? It was this way, hey?
Yeah.
Or was that way? Right, let's go back. Let's go and see if we've got any movement. I was hoping to pick up on the odd elephant, but it doesn't seem like that. That is going to happen today. So, oh, someone's trying to say something, but I can't quite hear what they say. Ah, we're not too far now. I even put a branch in the middle of the road to remind myself where to go. Right. Obviously, it's a little bit further down than I anticipated, but that's okay. We're almost there. Now, I can't see the other impala or if it was a wildebeest. That was alarming. It doesn't seem to be too much around here. It's actually very quiet. Okay, let's go. Let's go back in. I can still just see upside down bellies. Oh, wonderful. Fantastic. Louise has just fed something very exciting into my ear. Well, she says that the email is now up and running again. Watch out, Chandra. So you're welcome and can continue posting or sending us questions to questions@wildearth.tv. Just move that little tree quickly. Don't worry, it will bounce back up. Oh, the lions are still not doing anything. Looks like they're still just sleeping. Let's see if we can get a different angle. We'll just poke our noses in just for a moment. Just have a very quick look over here. Not the greatest view. Bless you. One of the lions sneezed. I always think it's good to just to say bless you. Sadly, no development here. I got quite excited for a moment. I thought that perhaps maybe they'd seen the lions and they were on the move. And I think I was actually really hoping those impala or whoever was alarming would be a leopard. It'd be nice to see a spotted cat. But I can't be too greedy. Well, we can't be too greedy. At least the Nkuhumas are around for us. So we've got that to be thankful for. And you can just see my favorite little girly all cuddled up in there, fast asleep. Okay, I think let's go back again though, because I suspect that these lions are going to sleep for most of the afternoon and is rather warm. Now we need to reverse. Hi, lions. let's go out again and we'll do another little loop. Maybe we'll check Triple M very quickly and see if we can pick up maybe Shadow or that leopardess that had crossed onto the property is doing anything. Right, out we go. And luckily for us though, those Ngumas did move out of that drainage system because it was getting quite thick and tricky earlier when we were maneuvering around there. Oh, wonderful. Now, we're going to carry on and see if I can pick up on anything else this afternoon, but let's go across to James, who's on foot and has found an active den of some sort.
Artfark. Down here in this hole, everybody, is an ant bear. And if you're feeling a little down today, say artfark. It will make you feel very good. Artfark. Now, the reason why I think this is active is for two. Here, we have got tracks. Freshish tracks. I mean, look, they're fairly indistinct, but there are definite tracks here on top of the last rain. But most sort of damningly, if you like, for this hole, there are flies in it. And the flies are indicative that there's an artfark within. Now, there, you can you see the fly there? Now, those brownish flies are typical of artfark holes. They like to come and sort of sit on the artfark, I think, when he comes out. They will only come out in the deep night. They don't come out crepuscularly. Many of the animals that we describe as nocturnal, leopards, lions, civet, genet, all that sort of thing, get active during the course of the sort of sunset, so early evening, and they'll actually spend the majority of the late night fast asleep. The artfark, completely different. I've only seen two in my time out here, both of them after 10:30 at night. So they come out only when it's very dark indeed. And because they live in termite mounds, there's often been the kind of thought that they are only or predominantly termite eaters. They aren't, actually. They're largely ant eaters. And they'd like to live in termite mounds because, of course, the termite mounds are sort of ready-made and easy to live in, rather than the ant nests, which are much smaller. So they eat actually predominantly ants, especially in the summertime. So that is the active burrow of an artfark. Artfark, in case you're wondering, means earth pig. They don't look like pigs at all, really, do they? No. Anyway, that's what they're called. And I think for a long time, artfark was the first word in the English language, first word in the dictionary. And I remember that, of course, from the Black Adder, who unfortunately had to write one of write a dictionary once. You can go and check that out. It's in the third series of the Black Adder. If you haven't seen the Black Adder, you're missing something deeply in your education. Justin, you're wondering how deep that burrow was. It was probably about that deep, so from the tip of my stick down to there. But the reason I couldn't put the stick in, I mean, we got into the burrow only to about there, but then there was a subterranean tunnel that went off sort of perpendicular to the main tunnel or the main entrance, and I think that's where the artfark was living. They won't be in view during the middle of the day. Now, the other thing I was telling Dave, of course, is that an artfark is able to dig faster than human beings with spades. So hunters will often try and eat them. They're apparently very good eating. But they are so quick at digging, so fast and so strong, that they will get into the ground faster than two men armed with spades are able to dig. I think that's quite astounding. Right, now Herbert is just up ahead here. I'm not sure what he's found, but there's no sign of the leopard, so I think he's probably headed off to the south, unfortunately. So be it. That is the way I'll see her again sometime in the not-too-distant. Herbert is at the bottom of the drainage line, and we're sort of moving along the northern side. It's a lovely afternoon. I thought it might. All right, we've got a good signal here. Let's head across to Brent. We're going to move up onto the crest.
Well, unfortunately, it looks like our beloved queen has gone to the south. So, Brian and I have decided to go right down to the eastern boundary of Juma. Now, a couple of days ago, this was a little bit greener than the rest of Juma, and there were a few flowers, but with these scorching days we've been having, you can actually see the grass and the flowers wilt at the moment. So some of the flowers that I was hoping to find here have wilted away under the African heat. So very sad. But, of course, you never know what we might find. We are live, and remember, if you want to ask us any questions, hashtag safariLIVE or questions@wildearth.tv. Now, the one thing that we used to see a lot of that we haven't seen any of for quite some time is buffalo. Now, with the rains, they've also spread. Now, I saw a little bird. It was a very little bird. Oh, no, as Brian says. Oh, no! Wait, I can maybe do it. Okay. It's a bit naughty, but maybe we can do this. How far away? Right, Jack. Do you think we can see him from the road? Okay, so the red-crested Quran just did a suicide dive. So we call him the suicide bird. Have we ever caught a suicide dive on live drive? There he is. Okay, now this is a little trick that a lot of people don't know. So keep your eye on him. That sometimes you can convince, and I have no idea why. I'll just watch him for a second. He starts calling. It's amazing. It works with a diesel engine. So when we had our guests from Nat Geo here, I did that with a Land Cruiser, which is a diesel, that deeper sound, and it immediately made the Quran do his suicide dive. He's thinking about it. He's not buying it, Brian. Let's try to get a little bit closer. Maybe he'll buy it when we switch off and start up again. So with a diesel engine, it seems to work every time. Why don't you like the petrol? Back a bit. Hello, red-crested Quran. Now, it is a funny thing. So in the old petrol Land Rovers, it also used to work. Where'd he go? Is he still there? Is he hiding? Oh, there he is. Exquisitely well. I mean, you didn't even have to rev. You just used to have to start up, and that old used to send them up into the air. It was the most incredible thing. Now, I cannot understand why. It sounds nothing like any of their calls. It doesn't sound like a female. So we actually need to catch him calling. That's normally the best time. So if he's going, you rev your engine, it normally sends them into the suicide dive bomb. Now, of course, that's to impress all the ladies. So the more daring you are, the lower you open your wings to the ground, the more attractive you are. The African Quran version of peacocking. There we go. He's starting. Maybe come a little bit wide in case he does, Brian. I'm going to... Come on, do it. You want a dive bomb. You want a suicide. There we go. Okay, I'm just gonna start the car. I just think it's just not deep enough. So he's doing all the displays that normally lead up to the suicide dance. Now, very, very rarely we're lucky enough to actually see... Oh, there's another one calling. Maybe that'll be a better prompt. Very, very, very rarely are you lucky enough to see them actually raise their red crest. So you can see that little grey sort of hood he's got on, and there's a bright red crest underneath there. Isn't that incredible? So Hopefully. I mean, I don't think... I haven't seen the ones here. Oh, there we go. Doesn't want to do the display for us. At least raise your crest. That wouldn't be very nice of you. I think let's give it one last little minute or two before we move on to see if he does it. Because the calls are coming closer and closer. Come on, you can do it, little Quran. Show the girls how brave you are. Teasing us. So, just did the display in front of Brian, but he doesn't want to do it now. We'll try one last little vehicle start. No, I don't think he's buying my subterfuge today. Now, Liz is wondering, has a red-crested Quran ever missed his mark and opened the wings too late? Not that I've ever seen, Liz. They always seem to do it on time. Okay, mister. We did try. But I was talking about that wonderful crest that always stays quite hidden and where they get their name from. So there we go. That is the red crest of the red-crested Quran. So it's very seldom that you actually see them displaying that crest. There we go. Incredible, isn't it? Oh, he's on the move. He's on the move. Are you going to do it? Do it. Do it, Quran. Do it. Fly up and fold your wings. Oh, tease. Now, of course, it's quite a good strategy from a bird point of view to impress the ladies, because they don't have to be close to you for them to see. So they can see the display from a distance. Oh, here comes the wind. There has been some massive cloud buildup. Do you smell rain, Brian? Oh, dear. Come on, one last rev. Is he going to go up? I actually smell rain. It's just... have a look. I still think it's quite far away. I think what's going to happen, because this weather is coming from the mountains, it's going to be more of a windstorm. We've had a couple of windstorms. It's very unusual that we actually get rain from there. Anyway, well, we're going to keep going. And while we do that, James has found some matsuketsuch.
That is the sound that we make in order to attract matsuketsuch, to get them out of their nest, or their burrow, to come and say hello to us. Now, Brent was saying he can smell rain. I too can smell rain. And I think we're quite a long way further toward the rain than he is at the moment. Anyway, there are the mongoose, and this is the most perfect place to be in the rain. It's the most perfect place to be in the rain. What we have here, of course, is an old and disused termite mound. And clearly the termites are not there, and we know that because you can see that the surface of the mound has been eroded away. So it's a perfect little spot for thing that would threaten them in here would be a dastardly cobra or some such that might try and get in there and eat one of them. But other than that, they'd be perfectly safe. And of course, they're not scared of fighting off a snake or two. Doesn't it look like the most perfect place to be when there's a storm coming in from the south? A huge, big black cloud with sheet lightning every so often, and the little matsuketsuch are inside their little burrows very comfortably, I imagine. They're probably one or two underground there, putting on the kettle, maybe one or two putting the finishing touches to some scones with some thick cream and a dollop of strawberry jam. And shortly this lot, who are probably young males out here staring from the balcony, will go down at the call of their mothers and enjoy their afternoon tea. Doesn't that sound like a nice image? I've just heard David's stomach grumble there, and I think that sounds like a wonderful thing to be doing. Now, those aren't the only two. David, can we try and go up to those two there?
Yes, these two, yeah.
All right, everybody, we have got some extremely exciting news here. The great drone pilot, Connor, is in the air. Take a look at this. Now, this is extremely exciting. Of course, we haven't had a drone up for some time, since the days of Andrew Francis, the great drone pilot himself. He's since retired, went to join a guru, I believe. Let's hope Connor doesn't go the same way just yet. He's flying above quarantine clearings there. Now, what I think you can see from a beautiful view like this, this is quite a lot more sophisticated than our own drone, our other drone. This one will be able to probably give us a lot closer look at the ground, but what you can see here, I suspect, is how sparse the grass is. You'll be able to see that although you've just been watching us here on foot and things look quite thick from the air, things look a lot more sparse. The trees look like they're a lot further apart from each other. You can see a lot of bare ground between the tufts of grass. So you can see that even though our drought has in theory broken, the ground is not exactly covered in a great verdant flush. And the other thing I always notice from the air is how much browner it looks from the top than it does from the side. And I think that's probably got a huge amount to do with A, the drought, and B, of course, the bare ground that's in between there. And I'm sure, even though it's, I mean, we would never have been able to fly the old drone in this kind of wind, but this new sophisticated thing with, of course, our recently licensed pilot, Teagues, is, well, coping very well, it would seem. So that's a great big gorgeous overhead view of quarantine clearings, where no doubt there are mongoose about to have their tea. They've dropped their scones, they're coming out onto the top of their little mounds, and they're looking at the drone. Wasn't that special? I think that's marvellous. Now, we'll be using that quite a lot, of course, going into our television shows. And, well, I just think it's so exciting to have a camera back in the air. And just to remind you, of course, we will be doing an 8-week series from the 1st of January, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. You can work out what time that is wherever you are in the United States. That's on Natural Wild. For the internet audience, fear not, things will remain the same. Let's have one last look at the mongoose at the very top right-hand side there. You see him there, Davey? He's just sticking his head out. There. That's him. Marvellous. Now, this Taylor girl comes, goes to Florida, knocks about there, has a great time, comes back. Brent and I hack around, finding not much at all. She bumps into some lions, and now the long-lost and tragic figure of Shadow.
So isn't that incredible that this morning Jamie managed to pick up on some female leopard tracks and her suspicions were obviously correct? And here we are, we have managed to locate Shadow. I've got Tundi on the brain today. So she probably just popped across last night or maybe very early this morning. And while she's ventured back across, we're quite close to Red Dam on Arethusa. Now, for those of you who have probably never seen this leopard before, if maybe it's your first time and you've just started watching, welcome. And like I said, this is a leopard who goes by the name of Shadow. And she has a sister named Tundi. And she is the daughter, well, they are both the daughters of the famous Karula, who is the queen of Juma. Now, she's sitting up on this massive termite mound. She also looks a little bit hot. She was panting quite vigorously. And this is a really, really good spot because she's high up. She can see anything that's coming towards her. And I'm hoping that what she's looking for is perhaps an impala ewe with a newly born lamb. And we know what happens is that when they go off to give birth, they leave the comfort of the herds and they come out to these denser thickets where they'll hang around for a couple of days to a week before the little ones can obviously use their legs quite well. Isn't this wonderful? And she's just looking so beautiful. I haven't seen if she's eaten recently as she is hiding behind a part of the termite mound, but maybe she'll get up for us and show us. And I don't know when the last time Shadow was seen. I've only seen Shadow once, and that was probably in the first week that I started working here at Safari Live. Now, she's a relatively easy leopard to identify, and the way that I remember her is that she's a fully grown leopard with a pink nose. You'll see, there we go, which is obviously quite unusual because that sort of pinkish color on their nose tends to disappear as they start to get older. And well, she's still got it. And you can see the beautiful, beautiful spot pattern that she's got. She's got four, is that the right side of her face or is that the left side of her face? No, that's the right side of her face. You can only see three spots. Can you see three spots there? One, two, three. And then let's see what she's got on the other side of her face. Oh, look how kind she is, almost. And it looked like she may have had four on the other side of her face. If I'm correct, I think she does have a 3-4 spot in. And of course, now she's plonked herself down that we're just getting a little view. And I'm so glad that you're all excited to have a look at her. Wasn't that lovely that she managed to just poke her head up just for a little bit? But now she seems to have tucked back down and gone to sleep for a little bit longer. And I'm sitting up on the door, just stretching my legs out. They're getting a bit cramped. And well, we're just going to have to play the waiting game. And what's quite nice is that we've got Shadow here and we've got the Kahuma's not too far from here. I wonder if we shouldn't try and get a better position. I'm actually just trying to wonder if we are going to get a better view. What do you think, Jandre? Do you think if we go all the way around, or do you think we should just hang tight here?
Go further back, more of an angle.
Okay, maybe we'll do that. Let's try reposition slightly. Hang on, sorry, I just want to... Jandre, I have a beetle. I'm going to keep you in my book. Stay there. Right, let me quickly climb back down again. If I can get back in. Take some maneuvering. Let's just position ourselves a little bit better. Are you looking at my notes? You're not allowed to look at my notes. Did he go off? We'll find him again. I think we might actually have a little bit of a better view here. How's that, Chandra? And you see her. A little bit better, but look how camouflaged she is. She's just keeping an eye out on us. Oh, that's quite nice. Isn't that lovely? Oh, I'm not unplugged. And she is a beautiful girl. She looks quite uncomfortable though, and well, I can't really blame her with this heat, but luckily the wind has picked up. You can see all that thatching grass and stuff growing, that's growing up on the Termite Mound, blowing around quite a bit now. Also the trees behind her, they're moving quite a bit with the wind, which is nice, and it's quite pleasant because it's bringing over a lovely cool breeze. And it's getting darker, the clouds are coming in. Maybe we're going to get rain, but I'm not too certain just yet. How big that is, Mama. Now, Anne from Canada, you were wondering what prevents the cats from hyperventilating when they pant. Now, I think it's a little bit different. Obviously, if I were to sit here and try and pant like a leopard, it's going to very much sound like hyperventilating. So I'm not 100% certain. This is a question that I haven't been asked before. I have to do a little bit of research. Maybe you know. Maybe someone out there actually knows already and can help us a little bit. So you're welcome to either hashtag safariLIVE. And remember, the emails are up and working now. So you can even send that through to questions@wildearth.tv. I'm just trying to think about it. I don't know, because the airwaves system is not too much different to ours. Like I said, I'll have to go and pick up a book, maybe read a couple of anatomy books, maybe a couple of veterinary books will be able to sort of help describe something like that. Unfortunately, I haven't really come across anything like that in our typical animal behavior books that we've got for the African animals. But maybe they describe it in cats and dogs, and maybe then we can relate it to the bigger cats. You can just see it's just reacting to a couple of little branches that have been squashed, but not too worried about them. Just twitching her ears. She's a lovely leopard. You can see that her canines are still nice and sharp. They're not quite worn down just yet. And that's because these leopards can live for quite a long time. They can almost reach ages. Oldest leopard I've ever seen, she was 16, almost 17 years old. Her name was Nottens. And well, Shadow, if I'm not mistaken, is only about 10 years old, so she's still got a long life ahead of her if she can evade the predators and other leopards and, oh well, just stay out of trouble, really. She should be all right. But this is wonderful to see that she is doing well. And I just wish she would stand up so we could see if she's had a meal recently. But I'm almost certain that she's been taking it full advantage of the impala lambs and the inyala lambs that are all around at the moment. No, she's got bored of that vehicle as it leaves the sighting. Now, Lindsay, you were wondering, since that Shadow has lost her previous cub, you're wondering what her reaction would be to Sandile if he would come back. I don't think it would be a very pleasant reaction because Sandile is still quite young, so he's nowhere near sexually mature enough to even think about mating with the females. And to say that inbreeding does happen occasionally, so if Sandile were to grow up and become the resident male of this area and Shadow was still around, there's a possibility that the two of them would mate. But I think now, I think Shadow would probably portray a lot of animosity towards him. There'll be a lot of hissing, a lot of growling, and I think Sandile would probably get the picture and move off because he could get a nasty swipe from his mother, so we probably wouldn't hang around for too much of the time. I think it would be a very quick, aggressive interaction, and he would probably move off. I think Sandile has now learnt the ways of the bush, and I think he's realised that he is no longer welcome around Shadow, and while he doesn't seem to to come around here too often, just every now and then reported sightings of him. I think the last one I heard of was in Torchwood or on Cheetah Plains, if I'm not mistaken, somewhere around there. But it would be nice to have him back again. She's just sitting here very, very quietly. A couple of Franklins also going off in the distance. Probably shouting at something else, but too far to be shouting at Shadow. Now, a couple of you have said that Shadow's belly is quite full. From the angle that I can see, you can't really get a clear indication of whether it's food, and I can't see any swelling around her mammary gland, so it's a very difficult one to comment on right now, but I'll definitely keep it in the back of my mind for the moment that she gives us a full view, whether she stands up and repositions, and we'll have a look. Now, a couple of you are wondering if she could perhaps be pregnant. It could definitely be a possibility. We know that she's been mating quite a bit with Tingana. So we will see. And they've got a very, very short gestation period of only about 3 months or so, give or take a little bit, of course. So that could definitely be the case. But let's see, I think though, in my opinion, I reckon though, that if she is, if anything, it's probably something that she's eaten. Like I said, there's an abundance of food around at the moment for the predators, especially something like a leopard, and they are going to be taking full advantage of what's going on at the moment. Come on, give us a nice yawn. You see a bit of hair or something she had in her mouth. And this is a good sign. A little groom. Ah, oh, beautiful. Lovely canines. Oh, did you see that spider hunting wasp that just buzzed past her head? I don't know if you noticed that on the left-hand side of the screen. There is a couple of them that seem to be flying around here. Perhaps they've been seeking sort of the coolness and an odd, looks like a warthog or an aardvark burrow that's also inside this termite mound. So perhaps they've been resting up, keeping out of the heat of the day. You can see the entrance just over there. Isn't that lovely? Look how well camouflaged she is on this termite mound. When we came into the sighting, we just spotted her head, just peering up from that little bit of grass that's growing up on top of that mound. Other than that, there wasn't really much to her. She was so hidden behind the mound and, of course, all that grass. Here we go. Give us, stand up, girl. Let's have a little look at you. I think she might move. We'll see. She's looking a lot more perky now. She's quite interested in everything that's going on around her. But it seems as though the sighting seems to be getting quite busy. There's a lot of vehicles pulling in here now. And unfortunately, I can't seem to get hold of any of the guides coming into here. So we probably won't be able to stay too long. So I think what we're going to do now is I think we're going to have to say goodbye to Madam Shadow. I know it was a short sighting, but short and sweet, and it's good to see that she's doing well. But I know that there are a couple of guides, by the sounds of it, that are itching to come in and have a look at her too. So we'll say goodbye to her, and let's go back across to James, who's also sadly going to have to say goodbye to you shortly.
Right, everybody, as the storm starts to blow in here and the light starts to fade, Bushwalk is going to say goodbye, but only once we've had a look at a golden-breasted bunting. Can you see it there? On the top of that tree. Gorgeous bird. Looks like it's wearing a cycling helmet. You got it there? Yeah, you got him. There he is. The golden-breasted bunting. Beautiful. And he has a gold breast, believe it or not. And he's making his little swizzling call. What a perfect way to end our little bushwalk. I'm hoping that this cloud is going to deliver something in the way of moisture tonight. Not before the game drive is up, obviously, but hopefully sometime soon. All right, everyone, that's going to be it from us today. We'll see you tomorrow, of course, very early in the morning as the sun starts to rise. Until then, stay safe and happy, and we'll catch up with you tomorrow. We're going to hand you over to Brent. Bye-bye.
Welcome back. We've been very, very slowly skirting our northern boundary, and so far we have seen one diker, one impala, and a windswept roller. And did you see that in the distance? I think it was a guinea fowl running across the road, to be honest. Nothing to get over excited about. But we're coming up towards the area around Sydney's waterhole. I don't know if there's anything there. I don't think so. I might duck in before, just to have a look what's happening around Sandy Patch. Nice to catch up with Shadow though. I mean, we've seen her twice in the last couple of days, so more than we've seen her in a very long time. So unfortunately, when the wind picks up like this, the birding drops down, and also the mammals get a bit jumpy. Oh, there is a bird who doesn't seem to mind the wind. Probably enjoying a bit of respite from the heat, a little red-billed hornbill. There are some hornbill nests in this area, but not close to where we are right now. You can see the wind moving through the quarry bushes there. Not that strong yet, but it is going to get there. And off goes the hornbill. And off go the killer bees. Now, this is an area we do get luck with wild dogs from time to time as they move through at high speed. So always worth a gander. Area, normally a few impala, sometimes wildebeest, waterbuck. At the moment it seems to be devoid of any mammals. There we go. You can see the open area not showing much. There's another open area coming up on the right. Just sneak up there and stop for a second. There's nothing there. We're going to head back to the south. What is around the quarry bush? Here we go. A windswept plain with three impala. Not quite what we were hoping for. Okay, let's go look further to the south. Nothing happening here at the moment. Oh, there's the road. I nearly went past it. Okay. Now, we haven't seen the dogs in quite some time, and I'm hoping that changes soon. As, of course, most people know, wild dogs are my favorite of all the animals. Oh, here comes the wind. Well, that temperature has dropped to a slightly pleasant, I would probably... Oh, jackal! Yay, we found something new, a pair of black-backed jackal. I haven't seen black-backed jackal in so long. Hello, guys. Hopefully they do set up territory. They've got one of my favorite calls in the African bush. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we had a little jackal den with some jackal pups? Now, out of the two jackal species we see, the black backs are far more carnivorous, and not to say they won't eat insects, but they generally prefer meat. Oh, it looks like, there we go, as I said, what you got? You got a beetle. Yes, as I said, they will eat insects. Oh, you dropped it. Crunch, crunch. But of the two jackal species, they are far, far more carnivorous than the side-striped. And they are the ones who often harass lion and leopard on kills and even sneak in between the hyenas if they get a chance. I'll be very excited. I would be absolutely ecstatic if we got a pair to set up here on Sandy Patch. There we go. That is a scent marking sign, see? The one, it looks like the male on the left defecated and the female immediately urinated on top. Then they're a little bit skittish, so I'm not gonna move the vehicle. They should hopefully pop out into the open. Hello, Rebecca. Rebecca is wondering whether jackal are related to coyotes. They are, Rebecca. They are both part of the genus Canis, the dog family. I'm going to try, I said they're a bit skittish, and with a strong wind they might be a little bit more skittish. I'll try to get one last few of them, but again, I don't want to disturb them too much because we really want them to set up shop here on Juma. But yes, they are separated quite a long time ago, but they are part of the Canis family, the dog family. So they're probably as closely related to coyotes are to domestic dogs, and as jackals are to domestic dogs. I'm afraid I do not know the genetic lines of coyotes that well. I'm going to have to do some more reading up. Naughty Brent. Okay. So as I said, I'm not going to push too far. As I said, we don't want to disturb them. It would really, really be wonderful to have them permanently or semi-permanently in this area. So if I can't see them once I go past this quarry bush, I'm not going to push any further. But definitely worth coming to have a look. Oh, there they are. Long distance. Bebop. Through that gap. There. A little bit to the right. Well, that's where they were. They were there. They kept moving. So, as I said, I don't want to put too much pressure on them. So I'll definitely come look for them tomorrow morning. But hopefully they settle down around this area. This is an ideal sort of area for a jackal pair. When they do den, they like open areas with some termite mounds. They've got some holes where they can give birth to their babies. And have, being an open area, they like to be in the open so they can see the approach of other predators. And if we do get a den, they can become really, really relaxed, and it is quite wonderful to spend time with jackal pups. They're very playful. And of course, I would love to hear the call of a black-back jackal every night. Now, it is one of my favorite calls in the African bush. Do yourself a favor, if you're online, see if you can go on Google and look up a black-backed jackal audio clip or file. I'll try, but it's going to be a very bad rendition. But it's something like this. But much prettier. That was horrific. I know, I apologize. We should leave the mimicry up to James Hendry. Well, Jimmy, would like to know, do jackals sound similar to coyotes? Well, if they sound anything like that horrific noise I just made, then maybe. I'm not sure. I can't really remember. I think I heard coyotes when I was in the States, but it was a long time ago. I'm going to have to go. When I get home, I'm going to have to look up the audio call of a coyote. And maybe tomorrow I'll be able to tell you, Jimmy. But for right now, I'm not sure. I would guess so. A lot of your small canid species will sound relatively similar. Side-striped jackal doesn't sound anything like black-backed jackal, though. They're more of a yip, and they only really make sound when they are when they've spotted a predator and they're alarm calling. Hello, a zombie cow. Zombie cow is asking, is there a size difference between the male and female jackals? Indeed, there are. You could see it there. The male was a bit bigger than the female, so there is a size difference between the two. Okay. Well, that's great. I mean, when was the last time you saw a jackal, bro?
Not a long while.
Oh, it has been a long while. I think the last black-backed jackal I saw in Cheetah Plains, but some months ago. Definitely months, not weeks. Now we're just going to bump around the corner and we'll have side-striped jackal on the next open area. I hope, I doubt, but I hope. Oh! Oh, they've arrived! Look at that. All the way from Asia. And they've had to pass some horrific netting and harvesting, but the Amur falcons are here. Arrived with the rains to feed off the insects. There's a big flock. I mean, you can get flocks of tens of thousands on the high fault grasslands. Low fault, I have seen flocks of over 1,000. This is a smallish flock, probably 100 and so in total. But Amur falcons, there's probably a western red-footed in there as well. But from this distance, you can't really see. Isn't that incredible? The Amur falcons have arrived. They weren't here yesterday, and all of a sudden today they are here. Riding the thermals. Now they travel massive distances to be able to feed upon the insects. So they migrate after insects. Very, very cool. One left. Where did the rest go? They're heading south. Now I think we might get some nice big groups on Cheetah Plains. Now they migrate. On average, oh, you still got some. About 11,000. You got him? There's the last one. 11,000 kilometers. And they go right through India. And they specialize in exploiting insect emergences. So yeah, Deborah, the armchair traveler, says that Amur falcon. I didn't catch the number. Is a number on her bird list? But Deborah, your bird list must be getting quite big by now. There we go, 169. And well, hopefully we'll get to see them up close at some point. There we go. There's the little male Amur falcon. Very pretty, pretty little raptor, but an insectivorous raptor, so feeding almost exclusively off insects, and that's the female looking like that. Now, you must always be quite careful, sorry, but I'm going to have to do this, to keep a lookout for the red-footed falcon, which is often in the groups of Amur falcons, and you notice the male Amurs have the bottom side of the wing is white, the red-footed is, of course, dark. The females of the red-footed, again, quite different from the Amur, and they've got their very buff chest, not the white stripy chest, but often you will find them in the big flocks of Amur falcons. And also when they're around, we saw one, and I've only seen one since I've been here, and sometimes around with those flocks is a slightly bigger European hobby falcon. Now we've only ever seen that once on the live drives last year. So there we go. So I'm very excited that the little raptors are back. As you know, I am a lover of the birds. And one of these days, the killer bees, when they choose their moment, we're going to make a play at our record. Our record of 38 bird species in a single live safari. Brian, do you think we can beat it?
Of course.
We can beat it. I think we're waiting for a little bit more rain. So it brings in a few more migrant species so we can actually have a good go at that 38. Viam and I came close while Brian was on leave on birding big day. And we got to 36 in a single morning safari. Okay, it seems like Taylor has broken a brake line on Jigger, so she's lost all the brake fluid, which means she doesn't have any brakes, which is actually not the biggest problem in these vehicles. You can just put them into low range and go slowly for a drive, but it's not something you want to go, so she's going to see if they can go plug it quickly back at camp. So that has changed the Killerbees' plan. The Killerbees shall now go towards the Nkuhumas, which we weren't planning to do. We were planning to head towards some baboons that were around the Juma Dam Cam, but if Taylor is out of service, we shall go towards the Nkuhuma Pride. It is the right time of the day to head towards the lions. They might be up and mobile, and they're not too far from where we are, and as we come up here, we can see there's a herd of impalalas. Hello, impalalas. Careful, there are lions down the road. And we're quite sure that the Nkuhuma's got a baby impala this morning. When we found them on foot, there was a poor female impala sticking close by and calling for her baby. Now, this is our nice big herd that hangs around Impala Plains through to Sandy Patch. Now, isn't it fitting, Brian? Look at all the impala on Impala Road. Last year, the first baby impala of the year was seen on Impala Road. This year, it was on quarantine. Well, you can see that little skip and a jump from that baby impala because it is Karen Gillen's birthday today. She is, of course, one of our administrators who works with us and helps keep everyone well behaved in the interwebs. So a very, very happy birthday from the Safari Live crew on the ground here at Karen, and hopefully we'll see you out here in the middle of the bush one day. Okay, let's keep moving towards the Nkuhumas. Bye, impalalas. Watch out for the lions. Oh, highly mobile. Leopard, tortoise. There we go. Left. There we go. There we go. Highly mobile leopard tortoise. Oh, he's slowed down now that he's found some cover. Oh, don't trip. Slow yourself, tortoise. Slow yourself. No need for the panic. Or maybe there is. Impalas have just... panicked in all directions, and it definitely wasn't from the leopard tortoise. Where are they snorting? Where are they looking, Brian? That way. Was there a sneaky leopard behind the leopard tortoise? Or is it the Nkuhumas on the move? It's most likely the lions on the move. Hold on. Bye, leopard tortoise. There he is. I definitely don't think you're the one that scared the living daylights out of the impala. But in this wind, the impala might have scared the living daylights out of themselves. Just have a quick look through here. And if we can spot a kitty cat. Snorting from other impala up ahead. And I thought I was being so funny. Leopard, tortoise. I think those impala might have got a whiff of lion or something and had a complete panic. But it's always worth checking. Okay, I'm gonna actually go a bit faster towards the last position of the Nkuhumas now. No large stumps behind us. No, just joking. So all the impala were just happy as Larry here. And then snort and bombshell while we were looking at that tortoise. Just have a quick look here. Now the lions were probably 300-400 meters from here, as far as I know, where Taylor left them. So very close to where we found them on foot this morning. And maybe they got a whiff of the ever so potent Eau de Lion, as we all know, after spending a lot of time with lions, especially Brian and myself have been nearly brought to being ill by the odd deposit or flatulence of a lion. Although for some reason the lions always seem to need to deposit very close to where we are. They'll get up, walk next to us and leave a monster that the smell just... Ooh, lion poo is very, very smelly. Not nice stuff. Just make sure there's no tracks going across the road here. Now, let me just try to see where Shadow was from Taylor. Because, I mean, Shadow could also have easily snuck into this area. Taylor. Taylor, where was Shadow's exact position? And did she come back towards the west? Or to the east, sorry. Copy, no problem. I was just checking. We just had a bunch of impala alarm calling, so just making sure that where exactly she was. I think it might be the lions. I'm just going to check their last position now. Okay. Now, where were the lions? Somewhere off here. Is that an off-road track? There was one there. I do remember saying she dropped a branch at the easiest spot to get in. Who knows, maybe the wind blew the branch away. If nothing, we'll go back to those off-road tracks there. Are the Nkuhumas on the move? Was it their smelly smell that sent the impalas into panic? I'm not seeing any other vehicle tracks. Are you? And Brian. There. They've moved. But I think it was just a whiff of lion. There's impala in a direct line from here. Now that is a carpet of cats if I've ever seen one. Hello, kitties. I'm sorry I gave you such a big fright while I was walking this morning. There we go, a carpet of cats. They've moved a little bit out of the drainage line, and I think that is almost certainly, with the direction the wind's blowing, what spooked those impala. A bit of lion flatulence. Well, if you're an impala with all those babies, you gotta be careful at the moment. All looking relatively well fed. I There you go, one of the little cubbies still suckling. Oh, fat, fat bellies. You guys been having a good time in the West? Apart from being chased by the murderous Majingalans. Seems like you were well fed while you were over there. Now, that guy is wondering, does a lion's heel touch the ground when it walks? Well, I suppose it all depends on what you consider its heel. So, I mean, there's the adult lioness on the far right. I think that front left paw is the best one. There we go. So, well, if you consider up where the dew claw is, sorry, to the right, but... And there we go. See, there's that other pad above the rest of the pad. If you consider that the heel, I suppose, that is the heel, and it does not touch the ground. So what we're looking at is that the front pad, you can see the three lobes and the toes there, that touches the ground. That top pad up there where the dew claw is does not touch the ground. So it depends on what you consider a lion's heel. So if you consider the dew claw the heel, indeed it doesn't. But if you consider the main pad of the heel, indeed it does. Well, these lions don't look like they're going to be doing much, do they, Brian? Now, quick cub count. How many we got? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6. So still all 6 present and accounted for. I think they're going to be loving this windy weather. And Sharon was wondering how many cubs. All 6 present and accounted for. Sharon. Oh, was that thunder? There's lots of lightning and thunder. We've got some fluffy cloud build up around us. Hello, Pete. Pete would like to know, will lions hunt during a thunderstorm? Indeedy, Pete. I've actually seen some of the more spectacular lion kills that I've seen in my life have been during a thunderstorm. Although I'm not sure how high on the list hunting is for these quite fat-looking Nkuhumas. Hello. Swapping suckling. Now, probably only a month or so of suckling left before the mothers are going to stop producing milk. Oh, they must be loving this cool weather, actually. Brian, I've got an idea. There's lightning ahead of us. There's a lightning there. I think that's a prettier cloud, though. Okay, we're going to just move. I'm going to try get a wide shot. So those screenshotters out there, get your fingers ready for the speedy screenshot. I'm not sure how to do a screenshot, but... So there's... I can see rain and some lightning to the sort of north of us. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put us to the south of the Nkuhumas. We've got some pretty clouds to the sort of northwest of us, and maybe you might get lucky to get that very sought after lion with lightning bolt. So you can actually see the rain there. Now, it's great to have the Nkuhumas back on Juma. Let's hopefully they stay for a while. It's dangerous out there in the West. Oh, there we go. Did you guys get it? How cool was that? It was just a little bit to the left. Lightning next time we want to be... So the lightning last time was there. We want the lightning to be there. Let me get my finger out because obviously Murphy's Law, while I'm waving my big fat finger around, the lightning will strike. Now, this is almost ideal weather for these kitty cats. It's nice and cool. Oh, that wasn't good enough. We need a nice bolt or some sheet lightning. Yeah, some sheet lightning to go across the clouds. Oh, there we go. Oh, who was quick enough? Who was quick enough? If you got a screenshot of the lightning and the lions, Remember to share it on our Facebook page or on Twitter with the hashtag safariLIVE. Now, most photographers dream of getting a shot just like that. Myself included. Oh, there's another one. Isn't that beautiful? Now, the one thing about this, the rainy season, the months, is you do get some spectacular skies. And I do love myself a good thunderstorm. Only after drive, of course. And, oh, there we go, roll over. I was hoping that these guys might get a little bit, oh, there we go, more active. Oh, isn't that stunning? Look at those cumulus nimbus clouds. And you can see, you can't even see, I reckon the main anvil of that storm is well above. It's even got mini anvils down here. So when those big storms anvil, there are winds of over 1,000 kilometers inside there. And they're said to be strong enough to rip the wings off a jumbo jet. So even the big commercial airliners will fly around the storms, the big cumulus storms like that. Or fly over them if they can. Now this is quite interesting. Oh, there we go! Who got that? That was the one! That was the money! What do you think? That was a good, that was a good bolt.
It was. I just kind of out the frame.
Oh
it
dear.
Was there, but it wasn't.
Oh dear. Okay, I think we, so guys, we normally, obviously, you know, we move around our shots a lot, but I think we're gonna stick with this one. Standing by Andrew. Oh, that was a good one. I think I got that one. Andrew, go ahead. Oh, that was also a good one. Nothing further. One station with Nkomas off the power lines, and that's it. Between Triple M and Impala Road, they're lying right out in the open on that SODIC area. Isn't this absolutely spectacular? That was a good one. Now, William is wondering, is the storm heading our way? William, it's very unusual for us to get rain from that direction, but it might be, but it almost seems like we're in the sort of middle zone between two storms at the moment, so it's possible that one of them might come in. Yeah, Johan, it's Brent, just me here, you're more than welcome to make your way. Isn't this absolutely spectacular? Oh, so no one's fingers have been fast enough, but I know a lot of you record the drive, and I think they're going to be some sneaky cheats who go back, slow it down, and oh, and catch those incredible bolts of lightning with the incredible Nkomas. That storm does seem to be coming closer. says absolutely spectacular. Oh, Tarjinda. Oh, that was the big one. Tarjinda says, you know what we've got here. Tarjinda is obviously practicing for stand-up comedy. He says, we've got Thundercats. There was a Thundercat named after a lion.
Was it? Lino?
There was a Cheeto, what was it?
Chitara?
Chitara was a Thundercat.
Lino?
Lino, yeah, there was a Thundercat named after a lion. Ooh, we might even get some sheet lightning now. And hopefully the cats are going to get a bit more mobile. Imagine a lovely picture. Ooh, there's more there. As the Nkomas stretch with the lightning coming through. Well, Olivia has posted one of her lightning screenshots on Facebook. Well, thanks very much, Olivia. I look forward to actually having a look through all of them. I'm sure you guys are going to get some special ones. Well, it sounds like a lot of you are getting some great shots of the lightning and the lions, and they're coming up on Twitter and on Facebook, and I'm a bit jealous. I think I might get one or two, but I'm biding my time. Oh, I missed it. Hi, Graham. Graham would like to know if we can hear the thunder. He says they don't seem to be hearing it on stream. I would say it's still quite far away. The next bolt of lightning I see, I'll do a count to see how long or how far away it is. It's more than 12 kilometers away, but I think there's different lightning in different areas. Ooh. 6 Ks. That one was a bit closer. Oh, flop down, kitty. So this is actually ideal big cat hunting weather, and a lot of the antelope, their hearing, their smell will all be compromised in this weather, enabling the big cats to get a bit closer. Oh, that one looked like it was a bit closer. Oh, the lions heard something, so we know. There's that big herd of impala, they got a fright, and I think they smelt the lions a bit earlier. Definitely coming closer, that lightning. Oh, it seems like Taylor has managed to fix her problem on Jigger, so she's back out. Let's go see what her plans are.
Well, Brent has used a very strong word, fixed. We're not quite fixed. We don't have any breaks at the moment. So we're just coming to do a little loop around quarantine, and well, I'm not going to be going quite quickly at all. And I know Brent and you were all trying to watch the storm developing in the distance, but we've got the most magnificent view from this big open clearing. So I think we're going to position ourselves somewhere where we've got a good view. I'm going to go a little bit further forward, and well, we're going to see if we can watch the storm coming in. Oh my goodness, there's some wonderful bolts of lightning coming through. And Jandre and I have got a game to play. He thought that I was going to chicken out and say no, but that's not the case, Jandre. Right, I think we'll probably stop over here. We'll see. Let's go. Let's go further forward. I've changed my mind. That's not a nice spot. Let's go out over here. Trying to see where there's a cloud that could potentially, I think there could be lightning coming around there. Oh, we'll sit here. Let's see if we can get a couple of bolts coming through. Now, the weather's obviously changed drastically, and I'm sure Brent has probably touched on it as well. From sweltering hot of 100 and, oh wow, did you see that one? Okay, I found where the cloud is shooting lightning from. It's just on the other side of this apple leaf. So straight through there, Jandre, there's between these two trees. There we go. Oh, wonderful. That is going to be an incredible challenge. I believe that Brent has given you all the task to try and capture a screenshot as a bolt of lightning illuminates the sky. That'll be very impressive if you're able to do that. What we'll do is, like Jandre is doing now, we'll try and keep it nice and wide so you've got a very good chance of getting a bolt. Jandre, do you think we should maybe go through these trees on to the other side? Okay, let's do that. We're moving around quite quickly, but I think let's get a nice clear view. We'll just zip around quickly again. And then Jandre, should we play our game while we drive? Yes, why not? Are you scared because we don't have brakes? Whee! Oh, did we? Okay, well, we'll go around quickly. Jandre, come, we're going to play our game. We're going to play Ching Chong Cha, or Rock, Paper, Scissors, as some of you may know it. We're going to do best of three, and the loser has to put this dung beetle, which you'll see hopefully closer. I'm not going to show you now because we're driving, obviously. This dung beetle on their tongue. Right, are you ready, Jandre? Well, ready is a strong word while we go around. I better use my good hand. Okay, that's a tie. Okay, one to me. Who's keeping score? Okay, one to Jandre, so we even now. Oh, two to Jandre. No, we've got to do three. But best out of...
You lose
that. I try to justify it, okay. Okay, wait, let's go to the storm and maybe you can get a picture of me with a lightning bolt in the distance with a dung beetle on my tongue. I'm a woman of my word. No, we tried to do this earlier with a live dung beetle and then it obviously got quite upset with me because it maybe shouted at it accidentally. I said, hello, dung beetle, really loudly, and it pretended it was dead. And then it sort of let off this very foul-smelling scent. So we didn't use that one. Okay, we're coming into position. Is this going to be fine here, Jandre? Okay, we'll just, when the vehicle decides to stop. Okay, let's see if we can get a bolt, and then I'm just trying to mentally prepare myself. There we go, there's a couple. Oh, there we go, there was your opportunity. That tree is in the way though. How dare it? That was quite a nice one. Oh, I hope we get the thunder that goes with the lightning. I can hear it brewing. So let's see. There we go, there's a whole lot. Now, James, you've asked a wonderful question with what happens after the rain, and you're wondering which insect is of greatest risk of drowning, specifically the ones that burrow. Now, that could be from anything from a millipede to a scorpion to any of the little beetles, of course, that can go under. Dung beetles, some of the dung beetles that obviously live underneath the ground rather than just inside the dung. But I reckon scorpions will have to get out pretty quickly because they make deep burrows. But there's so many different beetles, I suppose, that make their way underneath. But I think that they're quite good at escaping just before their burrows do flood completely. Now, we'll wait for one more set of lightning to come through, one more wave of lightning. And then I suppose I better complete my failing task. I'm very disappointed with this. Then I have to put this dung beetle on my tongue. There was another one. I hope you're all getting this. Remember, if you do get a really good screenshot, or any of them, of course, we love to see your pictures. You can hashtag safariLIVE on Twitter, or you could even email us questions@wildearth.tv. And I think that that's quite a wonderful challenge that Brent has set you this afternoon. It was really, really quite tricky even to sit with a camera and try and do something like this. Now, remember, we are selling t-shirts and all sorts of other goodies, hoodies, tote bags, mugs, you name it. And you can go to shop.wildearth.tv to go and have a look at those. Remember, it finishes on the 14th of December. So get on ordering those. Remember, it'll help fund us hopefully next year to go to Luangwa in Zambia, maybe back to the Mara in Kenya, and of course, hopefully to see those gorillas again in Rwanda. So wouldn't that be fantastic? Like I said, it's a good opportunity. If you haven't bought your loved ones a Christmas present, well, who doesn't love safariLIVE? And I hope there were some really good opportunities now to capture that storm, but I suppose I better do my task. Okay, are you ready for this, Rondo? I'm not. I don't know if I'm mentally prepared. So,
have to lean far back, so
am I gonna have to go for, should I stand outside? Let me just stand just outside. Whee! Jump down. I took my hat up a little bit. Are you ready for this? I'm not ready. And I'm sure that Kirsty and Louise are having a good laugh. And I apologize, please don't look at my nails. We were digging underneath the vehicle because I clipped the brake line and a bit of fluid was coming out. So my hands are not clean anymore. Okay. Wait, no, no. Where did it go? Oh, no, now it's in the sand. Okay, well, I suppose a bit of dirt didn't hurt. Anyway, okay. There's wind. I need a windbreaker. I'm done. I'm not doing that anymore. That's me done with the beetle in my mouth. Sorry, I've kind of come unplugged there, but I proved I did it. Are you impressed, Jandre?
Sufficiently, yes.
Jandre is sufficiently impressed. That tasted delicious, especially with all the extra sand I got. Mm. What a win that was. I won't need any dinner tonight. The things we do, the crazy things we do. Isn't that beautiful? I think this is the first opportunity. Oh, wow, did you see that? This is the first opportunity I've had, and I've also been saying this, that I've been waiting to watch a storm develop in the distance. And these two game drives have actually been really, really special for me because I finally found the flower, the lion's eye that I've been looking for. And now a second thing, I've been able to see the storm develop as well. That's amazing. Now, Jamie from New Zealand was wondering, what did I miss the most when I was away in the US of A? I really missed the South African accent. I didn't ever think that I would miss that. It was quite strange. Oh, wow, 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 that was incredible. To be surrounded by a completely different accent. And I'm well used to it from guiding. Like, that wasn't too much of a bother, but then there was always, you know, the South African accent behind the scenes. So that was something. And I missed our food. I missed the good old braai. Barbecues were amazing. Oh my goodness, you know how to smoke meat and do all those amazing things. Like, that was quite an interesting, different experience. We don't really cook too much like that, so that was nice. But I missed a good old South African braai, the smell of wood burning before you put whatever you're planning on eating on the coals. So that was, of course, definitely something that hit home hard. And then what's not to miss when you're out here and you get to spend every single day in the wilderness. I really miss that a lot. I miss the animals. I missed waking up to no noise, but that I even miss when I go on holiday to the concrete jungle. But it's good to be home, and I'm so happy to be back, and I can't wait for every single drive. But sadly, it's time for me to say goodbye, and hopefully Jandre and I make it safe and we don't bump too many things on the way home. We'll take it easy. But it's been a wonderful afternoon. Remember, we've of course got the sale on all the different items, from the hoodies to the t-shirts, the mugs. So head on over to shop.wildearth.tv to have a look at those and see what you can get. Remember, 14th of December is the closing date, so you need to get them in soon. It's only a couple of days that you'll be able to buy anything like that. So for myself and Jandre, have a wonderful morning wherever you may be, and we will catch you on the sunrise drive. But let's go back across to Brent and see what he's up to.
Well, we're still sitting watching this incredible storm roll towards the Pride, and the lightning is getting closer. Of course, we're not going to put any lights on as the cubs are here, but we can enjoy the illumination of nature with the lightning striking in the distance. Now, we are getting very close towards the end of the show, and I think we're just going to sit here and enjoy this African storm rolling in towards the Nkuma Pride. You can see that the storm is much closer. The frequency of the lightning is increased. Let's do a count the next time we see a flash. No, we need a full flash, not a back flash. We're still behind. We're waiting for one of the lightning bolts, probably the closest to us, rather than the ones that are in the sort of eye of the storm. That'll do. 1-1000, 2-1000, 3-1000, 4-1000, 5-1000, 6-1000. 7-1000, 8 Ks. Well, I still think that's a bit further. We are battling to here with the wind. Wow, way! Isn't that spectacular? Nigel is wondering, do the lions run the risk of being struck by lightning in the open? Nigel, a much greater chance of the lightning striking a tree. So I don't think it is going to... It's a very, very, very low risk of the lions being struck by lightning. So as we go towards the last minute of the show, it's been wonderful having you guys with us. Isn't this incredible? Lions and lightning. You wouldn't think they would go so well together, but they truly do. So for the last few minutes, I'm going to keep chatting, but let's look at this exquisite, exquisite scene. So from all of us here at Safari Live, it's been an absolute pleasure. We'll see you bright and early on the sunrise safari, and hopefully the lions will have been successful in their endeavors overnight. And I think look at that one. We're gonna make a dash before we get wet or electrocuted back towards camp. But the killer bees, we're very happy to have had you with us. Baby warthogs, the first baby warthogs of the year. But from the killer bees, we will see you in the morning, and have a wonderful evening.